Hello, can people hear me? Oh, great, excellent. If it's too loud, let me know. So welcome to What is Digital Studies, a conference that ends with a question mark that we are going to answer today by showcasing the really impressively interdisciplinary efforts of scholars on campus who are teaching digital studies courses in departments like American Culture, which is having its 80th anniversary this year. This is part of that celebration. But also in communication studies, in screen arts and cultures, in German, in engineering, in the School of Art, and elsewhere. So digital studies was launched in 2014 as an interdisciplinary effort. It's already a very popular undergraduate minor degree among our students who see this as combining their interests in the arts, the humanities, critical social sciences, with occupationally relevant credentialing. In other words, something that will get them in the door at a tech company, which I know has already happened. So we were going to focus on the research of digital studies faculty who define the field here at the University of Michigan. We are blessed to have such a remarkable number of people working on digital media, but not just numbers, but working on digital media as foundational to everyday life, culture, and aesthetic expression. So scholars working in digital studies at our university work on mobile telecommunications, gaming, race, gender, sexuality, transnationality, platforms, politics, and power, which is not how it is done everywhere. So it is also my pleasure and honor to welcome Wendy Chun, who is sitting right here, as our keynote for this conference. I truly cannot imagine a better speaker to talk about digital media history and theory, since she is a pioneer of understanding the digital as material and understanding the digital's materiality as political. She is one of a very few digital media scholars with the background in programming and engineering who can write about software from the inside out. Her first monograph, Control and Freedom, created the field of software studies. Other people have messed it up since then, but she was the one to do it first. In her second monograph, Program Vision, she turns to a deep history of the digital through a masterful cultural retelling of the work of the algorithm, the work of memory and of programming, and most relevantly to fields like mine in ethnic studies and women's studies, the pivotal role of women as computers during the Cold War. Today she will present work from the third of her trilogy of digital media theory. So young to have a trilogy, but there you go. So this work is richly theorized with reference to continental philosophy, feminist theory, and a deep understanding and mastery of the materiality of computing machines. Her work established the ground upon which the emphasis upon software as a field of study, as something to be looked at critically, currently rests. She has set the agenda for software studies, digital media studies, and digital studies today. Her work is generative, groundbreaking, and innovative, but we have some time to go before we're going to hear it, so I'm going to get off the stage and invite those who are presenting to come up. Oh, and if you are presenting, please speak into the mic. Also, question askers, because this is being live streamed and no one will be able to hear you.
I wrote for seven.
I did too. Right. I'm gonna scare you straight.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good.
It's always a good story.
But I'm gonna be embarrassed if I are.
Oh, did you send those down? Yeah, so they're up.
That's an excellent point.
Yeah.
And no one here is really gonna be mad about anything that happens here. Because we all kind of know.
Hello? My name is John Cheney Lippold. I'm an assistant professor in American Culture and also a co-coordinator of the Digital Studies minor. I will be moderating this section. We're going to get right to it, though. Our first presenter is Amanda Lotz. She's a professor in communication studies. She works on broadband distributed television, and her title of the talk today is Researching Television Distribution as Digital Studies. So please welcome Amanda Lotz.
Thank you. I took the question in the conference title, Lisa, as a model, and we'll be presenting perhaps more questions than answers today because I'm at the early stages of a research project. And I am not a digitally native academic researcher. And so I'm very grateful that Digital Studies here has cast a broad net and is willing to allow some of us who started out in an analog era to come along. So in relation to researching television distribution as digital studies, I find myself in the midst of a book project that I'm calling Being Wired: How Cable Transformed Television and the Internet Revolutionized It All. And the first bit is less digital studies, so we're not going to talk about that. But the second point gets right to the heart of what I think digital studies is in relation to the research questions that I'm investigating. And so the book looks at two different disruptions between 1996 and the present in terms of changing U.S. television as a cultural form and an industrial entity. And so an important moment in that 20-year trajectory takes place around 2010 when broadband distribution begins to revolutionize distribution of video. And so some people might think of Netflix and Hulu and HBO Go as something other than television, but by the terms that I use and the definitions I use, it is very much television, just broadband distributed. And so what I've been trying to do with the project is now, with 5 to 10 years distance from some of these transitions, going back to what was and continues to be a popular frame of television dying and actually investigating what has and continues to transpire. And the answer at this point is that there were many things that weren't clear to us until about 2010, when Netflix and HBO Go started really changing the way people watch television. And so it was the emergence of broadband distribution that revealed the difference between television as a medium and broadcast television, a medium that was defined by its distribution technology. And so for all of, you know, basically our lives, we knew broadcast television. And broadcast television was defined by a certain set of affordances that came with the technology. Protocols developed, a schedule, because broadcasting is very limited, one signal out to many. Once you had that limitation, you had to have a schedule, you had to have entities organizing that schedule. So all of the things that we know or think of as core to television were very much developed because of the limitations of broadcasting as a distribution technology. And so this is what unmoors everyone so significantly when we get to 2010, because broadband distribution, broadband has really different affordances. We're no longer forced one to many. We now have possibilities of person casting. We're not tied to schedules. And so as a result, our experience, what television can be, begins to change significantly. So I covered that. Mm-hmm. So at this stage then, broadband distributed television provides the opportunity to rethink basically everything that we've ever known about television. And a lot of what I'm doing is doing that from an industrial perspective, thinking about the ways that television is paid for and the consequences of what television can be as a result. So thinking about the affordances of broadband distributed television, specifically non-linearity, the idea that you don't have to watch on a schedule at a certain time, the ability at a personal level to demand television instead of having it pushed at you by a network or a schedule. And then thinking about the different kinds of protocols that develop specifically for broadband distributed television. Things like portals, that's what I'm calling Netflix, Hulu, YouTube, all of those right now. And beginning to think about the distinctions within that category of protocols. One of the most disruptive changes, I'd say, looking at the broadband distributed space, is the prevalence of a subscriber-funded business model, which is new, not entirely new to television. HBO, Showtime, those were subscriber-funded in the past. But so much of our mass media and the media about which a lot of theories were built were advertiser-supported. And some subscriber-supported media are an entirely different thing. And so not only do we have this big space that's based on a different kind of distribution technology, but we're also getting the intersection of different business models. And then another key thing that I think is proving crucial in this early environment is vertical integration, and the way in which broadband distributed television enables studios to go direct to a consumer in a way that has not really ever been possible in television. And if you follow Louis C.K., we've got an unexpected early example of this. Not that this is where the whole industry is going, but it really raises some fascinating questions about the potential for creatives and for television as a cultural form as a result of these new affordances. So finally, I'm beginning to look even beyond television and to ask these questions about broadband distribution of media that we have an even more expansive history, both written and oral forms, have faced this crisis of broadband disruption a little bit longer because of the differences in the technologies. And as we uncover, really, what has happened in the last 20 years, where there was so much great work done sort of at the dawn of the digital era, looking forward, saying, what's about to transpire? Well, we now have 20 years of evidence to go back and rethink what actually has transpired from an industrial perspective. And I think what's fascinating to me is identifying the strategies that are being used, let's say, in television that haven't been tried in the oral space or in the written press space, and starting to think about what kind of lessons and cross conversations could exist there. And so you see here down at the bottom, you know, these are my core questions. You know, what have been the most notable categories of change and with what consequences? For content, for creative workers, and for audiences, which is also the question of for media and culture, and the way in which intentionally connected we have distribution mechanisms, cultural goods, a viewer experience, and the medium's role, again, in culture. The idea coming from a media studies perspective, even before the digital age, of all of these things very much connected together. Thank you.
Thank you. Also, I forgot to say, Amanda is also professor of screen arts and culture. I shouldn't have forgotten that. Next, we have Cassidaire. Cassidaire is a PhD candidate in the Department of English and works on questions of queer studies, trans studies, visual culture, and digital studies. Today, Cass will be talking about trans digital aesthetics in the age of the, quote, real name policy. Please welcome Cass.
I'm gonna set my PowerPoint up. No, you're right. You told me that and then I ignored you. Okay.
Maybe it's not. Sorry, y'all. This might be right.
Yes, great. It's fine. I don't really know how to do this well, so that's my problem. I know what the right buttons are. It's that thing when you're in front of people and you don't know how to do stuff. Okay.
Cool. All right, here we go. This is a cartoon owl. It's the focus of my talk tonight. Hi, my name is Cassidaire. Thank you for inviting me here. The title of my talk is Trans Digital Aesthetics in the Age of the Real Name Policy, which it turns out is really big, because that's a group of people and all the things they do on the internet. So I'm gonna try to slice that a little bit more narrowly today. I'm gonna talk, opening on the theme of the panel, what is digital studies, try to answer that question as it pertains to trans cultural production, which I think has a unique relationship to digital studies, and then move to two examples of divergent aesthetic tactics that evolved around the same time as Facebook and media like that were consolidating the real name policy on the internet. So one of the things that's most important to me, sorry, this is also subtitle or selfie pics and pixel selves. One of the things that is most important to me about doing digital studies right now is that digital spaces offer publishing, distribution, and organizing infrastructures for people who are too marginal, potentially too broke, to enter into traditional media environments. So I see using digital objects in my work, especially in an academic literature department, as a way to make sure that trans and queer cultural production, especially cultural production by people of color, gets circulated in academic spaces. So for example, there's a new trans women of color literary anthology that came out like a week ago that was put together online that is only distributed by a PDF that you have to do sort of enter in a sliding scale pay-as-you-go model to download. Vetch Poetry, which is a magazine, more sort of high art, like hip New Yorker trans poetry journal, not quite the same as the Trans Woman of Color journal, but still. This is a literary magazine of trans poetry and poetics, also organized online by people who are distributed in space. Some people live in Iowa, some people live in New York, and is produced as a PDF for download. So thinking about the ways in which traditional publishing apparatuses are limited, no one is banging down the doors trying to publish the anthology of fiction by trans women of color. And those folks are using digital networks to publish those things themselves. So this argument, you know, that digital distribution methods afford marginalized people new ways to communicate is in some ways an old argument that can apply to lots of different marginalized groups across cultures. So I also have Tumblr down there because Tumblr's another example of people doing this in the vernacular. But trans people are an especially interesting case, I think, because the infrastructural conditions of possibility that digital spaces afford, in particular the ability to manipulate one's appearance online and to articulate new forms of naming practices, are automatically trans ways of living that are sort of structured by digital systems. Trans people, and I'm citing this from like oral history, like old people telling me this at conferences, so sorry, there's no footnote for this information. But trans people were early adopters of things like Usenet forums, sort of like text-only based internet systems back in the early 90s, in part because you could use pseudonyms and you didn't have to be identified as a legal name or gender or have a physical description attached to you anytime you logged on to communicate. While I agree with many cultural critics that this type of anonymity did not actually produce a magically colorblind or gender-blind world, it is also the case that in the 1990s and early 2000s, trans people were able to assert aspects of their lived identities online in ways that exceeded the legal strictures of bodies and paperwork. So thinking about how these spaces sort of coincide with the beginning of trans movements, in part because these spaces afford people ways to articulate themselves outside of legal structures. And then Facebook happens. Then we have something called a real name policy. I'm still kind of working on the archaeology of when this policy is enacted. It seems that it was actually in effect for much longer before it became controversial in around 2015. But give me a break a little bit. Let's say that in around 2015, the new real name policy became controversial in the public eye, in part because a drag performer called Little Miss Hot Mess, who you can see publishes under the name Little Miss Hot Mess in The Guardian, started articulating the ways in which Facebook's real name policy, quote, hurts real people and creates a new digital divide. You can see even the ACLU kind of jumps into this argument. So Facebook established a way to verify identities, trying to consolidate identities around certain ad-targeted identity platforms or identity categories. One of the ways they did this by using a legal name. They later walked this back and said, no, it's not a legal name, it's the name you go by all the time. But the way you prove that is by showing your government ID or a combination of documents, all of which refer back to certain types of government ID. So Facebook starts using the same mechanisms that the state uses to identify certain subjects and to try to unify certain identities under state legitimated categories. When this happens, trans and queer people start fleeing Facebook, and then they eventually are all lured back because all the other social networks are boring compared to Facebook. But for a while, there's a mass exodus. There's a lot of controversy around this. It becomes a big question about how we understand the role of legal identity online in a space that typically has been understood as pseudonymous. One of the things that this does is it reiterates the primacy of legal identification systems in digital public, something that is sort of new in the history of the internet. And it also, Facebook is kind of a gateway login for other ways that we interact online. So if you go onto Airbnb, it'll ask you to log in via Facebook. If you're trying to sign a change.org position, it'll ask you to log in via Facebook. So if you don't have access to this particular nexus of internet public, you're really limited for interacting in the digital public sphere. So this might have broader implications for trans people who are already excluded from IRL publics by documents that don't allow them to enter into certain spaces, are also sort of seeing these strictures operate in digital environments as well. So, I don't want to linger on that slide. So briefly, I want to discuss two aesthetic strategies that have arisen in this period that contest the politics of representation and the sort of strictures of citizenship that seem to be embedded in the move towards digital real name hegemonies online. One of these is this weird vernacular discourse I'm not sure how to talk about yet. It's a practice of trans people using their IDs as sort of like stand-ins for selfies on Instagram, which Facebook owns, I'm pretty sure, and using them as before and after shots or as affirmative statements of identity and authenticity. I'm gonna show these in brief because they contain people's personal information, so I'm just gonna like flash them on the screen and like don't hit pause and like enlarge them because it's really rude. But I'm showing these as a genre because they seem to be a strategy of demanding certain types of assertion and representation, simultaneously one that defers to the state for confirmation of identity, so showing your ID is like, look, I got my new ID, this is really who I am, but also by lining them up with your old ID, showing the flexibility and fungibility of legal identities in the first place. So there's a vernacular, these vernacular reconfigurations of IDs I'm gonna show in a minute both operate as signifiers of stable selves. So it's kind of, you know, saying, yeah, Facebook, you're right. This is who I really am. You can prove it. But also in showing them in contrast to old IDs, show how IDs functionally are actual changeable documents, the flexibility of them as visual rhetoric. So here's some pictures, some before and after shots. Again, these are people who are showing, sometimes they're showing the change in gender marker, sometimes they're showing change in name. They're usually hashtagged for some way to try to signify, hey, look, I'm part of this group. And these are circulated online as a really common genre. I took a bunch of screenshots of these over about a year, and I probably have like 60 or 70. And that's just a public, open-facing Instagram accounts. Here's one I especially like because he combined it with this selfie of him and his cat. It's kind of hard to see. But using this is very sort of, it's a personal and intimate photograph that he's combining with his digital, digital iterations of his license IDs. On the other hand, there's just another aesthetic strategy that is circulating just as prominently, I think. And this is a more abstractionist, high art practice, not really a vernacular practice. And it's an aesthetic tactic that seems to say, you know what, like, fuck Facebook, fuck legal names, we don't need that. Like, we don't even need to be human beings. We can just articulate ourselves through the pixels themselves, using pixels as a strategy or a tactic to sort of get into the digital infrastructure and reorganize it the way that trans people want to reorganize themselves and their bodies. So this is a strain of trans aesthetics that converts body into pure pixel, ungendered and often non-human, pushing back against the politics of representation that asks us to put ourselves into a legalized form. So I'm just going to show a minute and 18 seconds of a video from a video game Lim, which is in the top, is that right? Top right corner, showing how this sort of aesthetic practice operates. I think I have it queued up. This is someone doing a review of the game.
Lim by Merritt Kopus. In Lim, the player is a flashing rainbow block moving about a maze. The player can press a button, and their block will change colors to conform to whatever colored block is nearest to them. But the camera will zoom in, and the block will begin moving uncomfortably slow. If the player releases the button, it will zoom back out. Their block will begin flashing colors, and possibly be pushed around by other blocks in the area. Once the player is caught, and the other blocks begin pursuing them, these aggressive blocks will not stop attacking the player's block unless they've managed to escape into the next corridor.
Aggressive blocks.
The player can become trapped in the maze by other blocks. They may be unintentionally pushed out of the maze, where they wander outside of the maze entirely, or, with enormous luck and patience, they can reach an ending to the maze where another block sits and begins flashing colors with the player's block. Being that the player is a block, and the other moving characters are also blocks, it becomes very easy to anthropomorphize all the blocks as individual people. Although important to others' critiques of the game, I want to try to avoid that and understand these blocks as vital, breathing, even alive, but not necessarily human.
Okay, so I just want to end on vital, breathing, even alive, but not necessarily human. So thinking about these two different aesthetic strategies that are divergent but also operate in tandem, sort of circling around the same axis of legal strictures to digital identification online, what happens if the digital becomes a space that mirrors state ways of identity fixation or state ways of identity control? And then what happens when people try to rearticulate spaces or ways of thinking outside of that that might actually operate to untangle the various forms of representational strategies or representational logics on which citizenship rests? Thank you.
Thanks.
Next up, we get to hear from Anna Watkins Fisher, who's a colleague of mine in American culture as well as an assistant professor at the Residential College. She works on media theory and questions of radical politics as well as performance theory. Her talk today, as you see, is the politics of parasitism in a network age. So please welcome Anna, please.
Thank you. I love microphones, so this makes me really happy. So thank you all for being here. It's really a pleasure to be here and to be working on digital studies at the University of Michigan right now. So my talk is called The Politics of Parasitism in a Networked Age. In their 2003 manifesto, the Tactical Media Collective Carbon Defense League argued for a new form of digital interventionism, writing, quote, "We need to feed and grow inside existing communication systems while contributing nothing to their survival. We need to become parasites." Some 6 years later, the late programmer and hacktivist Aaron Schwartz called for a new morality of institutional squatting in a blog post entitled Honest Theft, a blog post that was akin to Fred Moten and Stefano Harney's call to find ways of inhabiting neoliberal institutions by abusing their hospitality and seeking to be in but not of them. So my remarks today, I'll delineate the contours of parasitism's emergence as an ambivalent tactic in 21st century art and politics. I'll gesture toward how the parasite, taken up and played as a mode of intervention, has figured a distinctly neoliberal paradigm of digital resistance. But first, let me begin by sort of offering some framing remarks around what I see to be the kind of larger stakes of the current book project, which attempts to respond to the question, is radical politics possible in the era of networks? So digital networks have increasingly encapsulated the limits of resistance in an age of neoliberal globalization. They give form to the circuits of exchange by which contemporary power relations, and here I'm going to speed up this video. Digital networks have increasingly encapsulated the limits of resistance. They give form to the circuits of exchange by which contemporary power relations, from invisible and outsourced labor to ubiquitous surveillance, have appeared increasingly immaterial and imminently appropriable. Networks trace the complex feedback loop by which it has seemed any attempt to splinter the logics of capital is eventually co-opted. Any shadow of dissensus inevitably reintegrated as consensus. In a moment when no matter what course of action one takes, it often seems only to embolden existing structures of power, what forms of political action remain viable in a system from which there appears to be no way out? For some time now, the purity and idealism of radical refusal and utopian escape have failed to square with the ever more diffuse and improvisational character of neoliberal power. As Rita Raley argues of Tactical Media, quote, the moments of dissent and critique they produce are not simply oppositional because there is no definitive they to confront, end quote. So if to navigate contemporary life is to find oneself complicit with a complex matrix of financial markets and systems of governmentality, it would seem urgent that we rethink the modalities of resistance today. I argue in the book that this configuration has given rise to interventionist practices that appear to mirror their neoliberal context. Rather than simply affirming or internalizing capital's totalizing stronghold, however, I argue that these ambivalent practices have registered an insurrectionist style not fully perceptible to the system itself. So a key claim is that neoliberal policies and protocols have increasingly deployed a smokescreen of hospitality, right? They've used hospitality as a kind of, the rhetoric of hospitality as a smokescreen. And one that has affected a subtle recasting of the citizen as parasites. So workers' benefits are repackaged as entitlements for the undeserving, and charity is instrumentalized in the guise of corporate responsibility, inscribing contemporary social life in a logic of imposition of rent and taxation, credit and debt, and reframing the terms of neoliberal citizenship as that of a patronage system. So let me give a couple of examples of this. We can think, for example, of companies like Walmart that have attempted to capitalize, and also, of course, McDonald's, which I'll talk about more, have attempted to capitalize on their so-called generosity toward their own underpaid employees through public relations spectacles of charitable giving. And I'm happy to talk about this in the Q&A. We can also think of a campaign that McDonald's ran where they were offering their employees tips, right? Resources, how to save their money. So we have pack your bags, take 2 vacations a year. Of course, that's not at all sort of appropriate for people who are making under minimum wage. Break up your food into pieces. It'll result in eating less and still feeling full. Tea time, of course. And my personal favorite, quit complaining. Stress hormone levels rise by 15% after 10 minutes. Okay. And a separate website, employee website in partnership with Visa, McDonald's offered employees sample budgets as a part of an effort to transition workers to receiving their payroll checks via credit cards. that would charge workers fees to access their wages, right? So this is the kind of logic of a hospitality that is in a form of instrumentalizing, of kind of financialization that I'm talking about. Another example we might think of would be the new trend in prisons and jails where inmates are asked to pay for their room and board. Okay, so while these examples demonstrate the use of this kind of mock hospitality for financial gain, I'm going to show you a couple of other images that make explicit the recasting of the citizen and even the consumer as an unwelcome parasite, right? As public, so in this case as public spaces, and even commercial spaces are shown to be inhospitable in the interest of increased circulation, right? Keeping people moving. So these spikes that you see on the left are a part of this kind of urban space. And what you see here is an art project by the collective Space Not Spikes, and a project that is bringing in these kinds of mattresses and cushions to combat a kind of anti-homelessness architecture in the public space, which is all a part of a larger conversation about the criminalization of poverty, right? And then here, this is a local image that I took in our local Whole Foods parking lot on Washtenaw, where even consumers are told that they can't stay. They have to keep moving, kind of get in and get out. 3-hour customer parking only, which is really, I think, kind of incredible. So it is in this context that artists and digital interventionists, like the tactical media collective Uber Morgan, have harnessed parasitism as a tactic for exploiting the performance of hospitality, enacting creative reversals that make the system's interest in playing host, this kind of curious marketing technique, right, to making it work for them and perhaps against itself. So I'm gonna talk about one project, and that is a project that the collective undertook in 2006 called Amazon Noir. And for Amazon Noir, the group gained access to Amazon's digital library, downloading complete volumes of copyright-protected books sold on the site by manipulating the website's search inside the book feature, which I think we're all very familiar with, sending 5,000 to 10,000 requests per book, and then reassembling them into PDF formats. So the project is one installment of what the self-described big media hackers call their hacking monopolism trilogy, a series of conceptual hacks that targeted three of the biggest online corporations, Amazon, Facebook, and Google. These performances stage interference with their host systems, not through direct, open, or straightforward critique, but through exaggerated adoptions of their scripts. They share an affinity with what Slavoj Žižek and others have described in the concept of over-identification as a manic maneuver by which one pretends to take the system at its word and plays so close to it that the system ultimately cannot bear its participation. So after the thing that's most interesting to me about this is that after Amazon threatened legal action, the case was settled out of court, with Amazon buying Amazon Noir for an undisclosed sum in return for both parties signing a non-disclosure agreement, thus reintegrating the parasite back into their system. So not only does Uber Morgan find a kind of loophole in Amazon's marketing strategy, but by forcing the company to settle in secrecy, it reveals that the parasite, rather than eliminated outright, is kept at a distance. It's put in a black box, so to speak. Its mode of access is thus simultaneously recognized and disavowed by the corporation. And indeed, we see this something similar in McDonald's retreat to protocol, right, in the 404 message that the resource line that I showed you now redirects to. So Uber Morgan's intervention produces a moment of withdrawal, right, a kind of move behind closed doors when the host is forced to show the limits of its hospitality. Calling the bluff on their hospitality, the parasite affects a kind of change of register, which I think is interesting, where the host suspends its performance of hospitality, resorting instead to its sovereign right to kind of take a time out, to retreat to the black box of the law or to protocol. Now, such works are not radical, right? They're parasitical. They reflect a compromised and complicit imagination of resistance forged by the system itself. And the parasite hardly offers easy answers, but perhaps only more questions. The familiar critical gestures here are disarmed. Such a moment demands a more diligent metrics, a finer attention to questions of scale, To the question of how we locate and measure the event of political intervention given the speed of appropriation, networks force us to reconsider the efficacy and indeed the ethics of an imminent mode of critique, one no longer predicated on the reassurances of foreseeable ends. Thank you.
I feel really aggressive doing this. That's why I don't want to. I feel like I'm lurching at y'all. Next up, we have Stephen Muldrum, who is a PhD candidate in the American culture. He works on queer studies, STS, and health studies. Today, he'll be talking about queer protocols and program visions of LGBTQ health. Let's welcome Stephen.
So, hello, everyone. So today, I'm going to be discussing some early results from dissertation research, and I'm currently actually writing chapter one right now, so any feedback will be appreciated and immediately put to use. So the diss is titled Programming Queer Health. It's about protocols governing the collection and management of LGBTQ health data, the politics of healthcare reform and health IT, and contemporary government, and ultimately how queers, and particularly gay-identified men, are made subjects of a mode of governmentality in the contemporary US that operates through quantification, individuation, and the promulgation of guidelines for self-care that reflect new expert understandings of what it means to be both healthy and queer. So while the project is historically informed, my research really begins in 2009, and I would be happy to talk about that decision in the Q&A. So the project draws heavily on two related concepts. The first is programmability, or the idea of programmed visions, that comes from Wendy Chun, who argues that contemporary projects of governmentality are motivated by an ideology which assumes that computers and their users can literally program future outcomes based on data gathered in the past and on an ongoing basis in the present. The second major concept is protocol queer politics, or protocol queerness. This is sort of my own formation, and it describes a range of LGBTQ political programs that are centered on reforming policy, process, and method in the collection and management of LGBTQ health data and the administration of healthcare to queer people. So protocol queer politics has several conceptual origins that I've put on the screen here. The first is just kind of the basic definition of protocol, a set of instructions or a mode of ordering action, which is actually really important in clinical contexts. And the second is protocol as software studies scholar Alexander Galloway defines it. Galloway frames internet protocols as a grammar of socio-technical control. They are standards that foster unconstrained action and interoperability, which will become a key word later, through perfect control mechanisms that are set by regulatory bodies. And the third source of protocol queer politics, or protocol queerness, is from feminist technoscience scholar Michelle Murphy's definition of protocol feminism. Protocol feminism describes feminisms that emerged from the women's self-help movement of the 1970s. They are so named because they initially operated through the dissemination of protocols among feminist counterpublics, or sets of instructions on how to perform procedures such as cervical self-examinations or quote-unquote vaginal extractions before abortion was legal. However, protocol feminism also describes how the feminist health movement was later institutionalized and transformed from a grassroots effort into a mainstay of contemporary biopolitics. A similar shift, I am claiming, has happened in LGBTQ health, hence protocol queer politics. What was a marginal collection of movements in LGBTQ health, AIDS activism, and queer demography has, really especially since the election of Barack Obama, but in a smaller way before that, but really since 2009, has become tenuously incorporated into the healthcare system. So now I will present an episode from my research that dramatizes this process. So in 2009, as part of the stimulus package, or the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, President Obama signed the Health Information Technology, for Economic and Clinical Health Act, or the HITECH Act. This expanded the portfolio of a federal agency called the Office of the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology, or the ONC. HITECH charged ONC with regulating and hastening the already mandated integration of electronic health records, or EHRs, in hospitals and clinics. In the vision of EHR enthusiasts, EHRs will eliminate paper medical records and will simultaneously usher in a new era in biomedicine. Every patient will have a, quote, interoperable record that travels with them for their entire life through every clinical encounter and contains all relevant demographic and health information. Further, these records will be anonymizable and linked to a national, quote, health information exchange that will also incorporate other sources of health data, for example, traditional epidemiological surveys and things like that. It's a process called alignment. This exchange will then be accessible to researchers, biomedical researchers, epidemiologists, et cetera. So this theoretical future is really an archetypical programmed vision, one grounded upon modeling futures based on data gathered in the past and on an ongoing basis in the present. So after HITECH passed in 2009, a number of other key events took place. However, I'm going to skip ahead to 2015. You know, little things like the Affordable Care Act happened during that time. But I'll skip ahead to 2015 when the ONC approved a rule for collecting sexual orientation and gender identity data in EHRs. So the approved two-step question actually mirrored recommendations that were sent to ONC by the Fenway Institute, which is a major LGBTQ health nonprofit, and it's a clinic and an institute that actually has a formalized partnership with the Department of Health and Human Services and the Center for American Progress during the course of public input during the rulemaking process. So this recommended question, two-step question, was what ONC adopted. So by law, this question is to be incorporated into all EHRs by 2018. That same year, in 2015, ONC also released its 10-year interoperability roadmap. So theoretically, in less than a decade, there will be a national health information exchange containing detailed person-level health and demographic information on essentially everybody. This will include sexual orientation and gender identity data. Theoretically, this very rich data infrastructure will be available to researchers, and theoretically, research developments will then recursively feed back into EHR systems with new care recommendations for particular patients actively being communicated to doctors via patient portals before, during, and after clinical encounters. So you can think a doctor looking at a screen while they're working with a patient, they prescribe a particular medication, in that patient's record, something comes up that's contraindicated, and a little pop-up appears on the screen. So this is trying to create what they call a learning and living patient-centered healthcare system. So the benefits of such an infrastructure are fairly obvious. So better healthcare, lower costs, and there are a lot of, you know, benefits to this. However, there are also a lot of risks that the actors don't often talk about that much. And from my perspective, right, queers are, right, we're always just one sex panic away from being subjected to systematic surveillance, harassment, and confinement without due process. And in fact, some queers are already subjected to this, often on the basis of a diagnosis that would be captured in an EHR. So for example, we could think about recent HIV criminalization cases that have happened here in Michigan. There are a lot of HIV criminalization laws all around the country, but we could also think of, you know, certain psychiatric diagnoses that would be recorded in an EHR and open up you know, patient to vulnerability on that basis if cross-referenced with their sexual orientation, gender identity, demographic information. So right now I'm currently just trying to think through this. What does it mean that this particular programmed vision is something that LGBTQ groups actively participate in and promote? And further, how have new technologies helped foster conditions for new kinds of viable queer political programs, particularly this kind of queer politics that I'm calling protocol queer politics, that's focused on this kind of administrative reform process in health information technology transformation. So, thank you.
really appreciate everybody being consistent with time. I don't have to be forceful or administrative. Next up, we have everything set up. Actually, could you come in? Oh, we can do it. All right. We have Irina Rekatova, who is an associate professor of the Stamp School of Art and Design, is also affiliated with Women's Studies in American Culture. She works on questions of gender and technology, as well as design theory. And today she's going to be talking about Carrying Objects in the Future, Uncanny Valley. I know she is not real, but ... So please welcome Irina.
Thank you, John. And while my computer gets hooked up, I just want to say thank you to the organizers. It's just great to be here. And especially big thanks to Lisa Nakamura, who I think is bringing us together for this wonderful digital studies program at Michigan. So I'm using my computer because I opened a few links and didn't want to waste any second of opening up on a different computer. So this is a new collaborative project. It's not just a book project. So I'm really looking forward to questions, but also if you are interested in similar type of issues, please let me know. Recently, there's been an insurgence of new studies of objects, all kinds of objects, and currently I teach a course called Sexual Objects Seminar. And the general framework for my coming to this is through theory, and my last book was called Hospitality of the Matrix, which actually Wendy Chun was one of the reviewers at Columbia for that, coincidentally. And now I'm moving to thinking more about care. So Anna's talk and Scott's talk, it's like we're moving from hospitality to care, and that's where I am. I'm thinking about what our current, this realization of finally we're looking at caring objects and they proliferate more and more, and where do these notions of care and what these objects mean for us in terms of relationships, that's where I am right now. So my first example comes from a personal care assistant. Her name is Nadine. And she's made at NTU, Nanyang Technological University. I worked in Singapore at NUS at a different university. And a scholar from Nanyang Technological University made this particular robot. There she is. And you can see that she's a professor there in computer science and robotics. And she made a robot which she thinks would be a good personal assistant. We can have a sound. Let me just stop it for a second. Can I just unplug this sound one here? My second example comes from a small robot which looks like a cute animal, baby seal. Just make sure that I have nothing playing here. And this is a quote that a baby seal is particularly helpful because medication sometimes does not work, though it's one recourse on dementia patients. And here comes Pero.
Your nose off, you might like Oh boy. You're not.
Mary Seals help elderly victims now in a retirement home recover from their mental scars after Japan's March quake and tsunami disaster.
For some elderly survivors of Japan's March earthquake and tsunami, comfort comes in the form of a small white robot seal named Paro.
If I hold on to this, it doesn't matter if there's a typhoon outside. I still feel like I'm safe.
The Suisoyen Retirement Home is located in the middle of Japan's triple crisis. 1 week after the residents' return, robotics division of Daiwa House offered two robotic seals to the nursing home for free. The residents, many of them still dealing with memories of the March quake, treat the new furry friends as pets.
It's just as cute as a little living creature, and so everyone looks after it every day. It does sometimes run out of battery power and stop. But when it's got its eyes open, everyone stands around talking to it, asking it how it's doing, and things like that.
Suisoyen's general manager says using robots makes therapy easier in some situations.
First of all, it's necessary to look after the live animals when keeping them for animal therapy. That, however, is rather difficult in certain situations, and so in these cases, we use a doll, albeit a robotic one, as an alternative method to help people recover.
As the robots only hold an hour and a half of battery life, the residents normally hug their pets in the morning and charge them over lunch, so their furry friends are full of life again in the afternoon.
One of the criticisms which has been expressed in relation to these developments is that it's just another way of dying even more miserably. And the fact that it's mostly relies on profits for corporations who do not want to invest in proper care. So I'm interested in this questions where we need to update the notion of the uncanny valley as well, which was famously set up by Masahiro Mori, but it happened in 1970. And there's been very little attention paid to what kind of critical issues of gender, sexuality, cultural difference in relation to future uncanny valley we're currently going to deal with. I wanted to bring in here also another different cultural example of a new Russian Silicon Valley example. The place is called Skolkovo, and Putin, before invasion of Ukraine and the new Cold War, he actually went to Silicon Valley and he said, we need to have our own Russian Silicon Valley, very similar in a way in which a lot of Asian cities are doing. And so I hope that as a part of this project that there would be this comparative research also occurring, and both with my partners at Michigan University, but also in Moscow. And they came up after millions of dollars of investment with this particular talking ball. And unlike, and an interesting idea, I think, behind this ball is that to entertain the elderly and people in nursing homes, that unlike more service-oriented and rational, I would call balls, a Russian talking ball actually is irrational. It reads poetry, it doesn't answer properly, so its AI is based on the idea that mistakes and jokes are the ones which would make us feel more acceptable and not uncanny. So in one example, this ball is called an idiot, right? And the researcher says, you are an idiot, and the ball replies, I don't think you have a basis for that. So those kind of AI research, and I thought you might, I found an online footage in English about this ball. They were presenting it in Berlin conference, and interestingly, I just realized.
Recon is currently working on something.
I just realized that the researcher, Russian researcher, is wearing an MSU sweatshirt. So please.
Little less subservient. Lexi, the talking home companion, uses speech recognition technology to answer questions about the weather, traffic, and news, but also tell jokes and disobey you if you don't ask politely. Lexi's brain is powered by an ARM processor, while a microphone, camera, motion, pressure, and temperature sensors help it understand what's going on around it. The built-in speaker gives Lexi a voice, and the ring of LEDs lets you know what mood it's in. It has a Wi-Fi module for internet and updates, and Bluetooth for configuration through your mobile, but it can also work completely offline. So let's see how well it understands me.
Lexi, привет.
Hello, Lexi.
I am all ears.
How are you doing?
I have checked the traffic data and analyzed what it is like to be driving right now, and concluded that I'm doing fine.
Well done.
I must say that my Russian jokes sometimes sound the same to my students here. And what I want also for you to know that there is no desire for any anthropomorphism or making it look like a baby seal. So what's the connection here between welcoming, this notion of welcoming, and now moving to caring, right? Apart from the fact that I'm moving to the question of objects much more, and it brings up for me the issue of the automation of care and caring on objects. And again, what the basis for this metaphors that we are translating? Again, I'm interested in looking at it through critical digital studies and critical new media perspective. What are not future notions of self and not self that we are proliferating? How new designs like this can be tested? So in MDES program, we work with health departments here, various departments in the hospital, critical questions. And I'm also interested in what kind of desires are behind it, right? Both culturally specific, but also long term. And you can see that the nexus of human, animal, and machine is continuing in various ways. This is a vision from a famous London design bureau about our future care, that animals would be programmed, digitally manipulated, genetically manipulated, and then kind of we would be partnering in this symbiotic relationship through machines. So from healthcare to quality of life, and of course questions of entertainment, which will be big, and sex industries, and for now in my head I'm calling it roughly the internet of caring things. And I wanted to end with bringing us back to a commercial which aired not such a long time ago, just to understand how deep some of these issues are and how much more I believe the comparative feminist methodology might be helping.
Guys, this Valentine's Day, size really does matter. So if you want to score big points with your Valentine, go big with the big hunk of love bear from Vermont Teddy Bear. This guy is a 4.5 foot tall pile of awesomeness. He's big, he's soft. And let's face it, no girl can resist a teddy bear that's this adorable. The Big Hunk of Love Bear from Vermont Teddy Bear is no ordinary Valentine's present. It's thoughtful. It's romantic. It shows that you were thinking only of her in a big way.
Thank you.
I'm very happy. All of those presentations were great, and all of them have a lot of things that are separate, but also a lot of interconnections. And so we're going to spend the probably next 35, 40 minutes with questions. And so ideally, you have a question, but potentially would you have a question that maybe could connect between different speakers so we could drag out themes? Because I really like the idea of having what is digital studies be the question, but then we can answer it at this moment, and that part of this process is constructing a narrative of what we want digital studies to be at the University of Michigan. So with that in mind.
And I will bring the mic to whoever would like to ask a question.
I have one if people are wanting to think.
Do you need to be turned on?
Yeah. I'm interested in connecting especially Cass's and Anna's work together, thinking about ideas of authenticity and thinking idea. I really like the comment, somebody is taken at their word. And I really like the idea of having a real name be something that you have to prove, but some people don't have to prove it. I want to also intersect that with the people who are often asked to prove the real identities, in the case that I'm thinking about, are trans people as well as Native people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how do we intersect that offline, online separation together? But also just how do we understand the idea of, like, we often think of Google as like a confessional, that Google knows us better than our best friend. But that logic makes us think of that everything we tell Google is correct. So how can we trouble that?
Hello? Okay, great. Great question. Really, really good question. You know, I think, I mean, we're in an interesting time, right? When, like, Mark Zuckerberg can talk about the real name policy and say that not using your real name on social media is a lack of integrity, right? So we have the kind of binding of the moral and legal discourses there in the ways that you really kind of beautifully brought out. And I think that, you know, for me, I'm thinking about a form of critique of systems, of host systems, of a form of unmasking, which is kind of where I also kind of hit the limits of my thinking right now, because I'd like to think that, you know, this kind of active exposure, this sort of standard move to expose and to show how things work somehow has efficacy, right? It does something to the system, to the set of power relations. And I'm more and more worried about the fact that that may not be the case, right? When Donald Trump really has no problem being really uninhibited and sort of saying whatever. So the idea that, you know, there is a kind of performance at hand, that if we just kind of unmask, we'll be able to kind of effect some kind of change is not necessarily the case. So those are some sort of initial thoughts, and maybe you want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. My research looks at this question of authenticity through state systems and identification documents. And I think you're really right to bring up the linkage between indigenous people and trans people as two sort of like key groups who have been asked to over and over again perform certain types of authenticity. I just want to mark that this is like way beyond the digital, that like this starts in, you know, we have authenticity systems and branding systems going back to the histories of enslavement in the U.S., thinking about border crossings as particular moments of people having to prove who they are in order to access certain types of mobility. But the digital hasn't always been theorized in the same way. I think there's certain people who interact with digital spaces see it as unbounded or non-geographically structured space. And so my work asks how the role of bringing ID documents into digital spaces actually creates sort of pseudo-states or pseudo-state formations or actual like digital borders within what we might otherwise think of as expansive digital space. So if Facebook, if you need to show your ID to use Facebook, and if you need to use Facebook to get into other public fora, like comment sections, which are supposed to be for safety, right? The idea of having that is so that you can't harass people online, but actually what it does is exclude people who would actually be the victims of that harassment from that public forum. So thinking about how authenticity actually creates forms of security and securitization online that have already been instantiated in U.S. public spaces, but we don't actually see as operant in a digital realm. The other thing I want to say about that is, like, in terms of performance, there are some people who are working on subverting the real name policy in some really funny ways. So I saw a sort of like viral image recently of a trans person who had their name taken off. I think it was a disabled trans person who had their name flagged as being not real. And you have to upload a piece of ID in order to get your account, in order to access the appeals process for the real ID, for the real name policy. So you actually have to like do the thing, give them your ID before you get to argue that your name is what you say it is. And so as a test, they uploaded a picture of themselves doing some like Steven Universe cosplay, like instead of their ID document. And it turns out that whoever the screeners were just like, whatever. Like they didn't actually look at the ID document, they just wanted you to upload something so that they would have some data that they could circulate and attach to you. So there are some folks who are experimenting with like, what silly stuff can I get away with uploading to Facebook securitization processes, which actually, you know, opens up this question of maybe my sort of like hegemonic dystopic vision of the internet as a space where we all have to prove our legal identities can actually be fairly easily subverted by the fact that Facebook is performing securitization but is not actually regulating those things. So there might actually be some spaces or some openings within rhetorics of authenticity when people are saying, oh, I'm just gonna upload pictures of myself in funny costumes, which is in fact the opposite of authenticity claims, that actually gets taken up by the site as good enough. That's authenticity. So there's more space in here that I think maybe speaks to some of what you're saying about parasitism and the way that we can manipulate things within their infrastructures. So, yeah.
Sorry, to talk her to the mic for the.
Thank you, everyone. So I just wanted to pose sort of a general question on like what a potential maybe transnational lens would, how it would inflect maybe your projects or the general scope or frames you're using. So even thinking of like parasitism as mode of internet access, for instance, or other platforms, casts, like I know in Brazil, the former Google network Orkut was very big. So if, like, how does their identification policies factor in? So, and maybe even like broadcast or different distribution channels in like places where, right, differential access to internet is a issue. So I don't know if everyone or whoever is interested by that question could respond.
No, the project is necessarily domestic because these issues are so different in other contexts, both in terms of the history of broadcast distribution. And the US is really uncommon in terms of its period of cable distribution. There's really only four other countries around the world that have that period of cabling in the way that we do, which becomes then interesting when you talk about this transition to internet distribution. And so all of the institutions are really particular around the world, both the previous forms of distribution and the dynamics of the new forms. You know, so a big part of the US situation is the monopoly structure of internet provision, which isn't necessarily the case in other places. So I think it's at an investigation level, I think at this point it's really difficult to look more broadly, but then there are also these components that are making the distribution of television international in ways that hadn't been possible before, and there I'm thinking particularly about Netflix availability, and of course it's running effectively as a different network in different regions, but it really hasn't been the case that television was able to travel around the world effectively simultaneously in the way that some of their contracts are now beginning to create, and I think that we're but at the top the tip of that change in distribution practices. Thanks.
Yeah, my work is similarly domestically bound, unfortunately, but your question about transnationalism made me sort of think on the fly that a good research method for me would be to compare the types of documents that Facebook asks for or demands from people in other states, because you know, what data that certain states collect on their citizens is an extremely culturally constructed practice, has changed over time even in the US. Like, we used to demand in California marital status to be on your driver's license in the 50s, because that's when we thought that marriage was a really important part of your identity, right? So I'm wondering how, if Facebook has particular demands for what data sets they desire from their users, does that actually supersede what states in their own cultural context desire to collect from citizens? Thinking about that too in terms of like the 52 different gender options that Facebook now allows you to have, one of the critiques of those from trans people themselves is that those are not transnational gender categories. Like, we know from transnational feminisms that gender is culturally constructed in sort of micro locales. So just having all the different things that kids call themselves on English language Tumblr does not reflect the vast variety of, you know, indigenous or cultural contextualized forms of gender identification. So is this a way, are these sort of like data sets on, you know, seemingly non-state forms of data collection actually superseding states' ability to have a conversation with their own citizens about what type of data becomes relevant to their own identities? I don't know. I should look that up. Thank you for that.
I'll just be quick. Thank you for your question. So I think you're also pointing to the way that we often, the way we talk about networks, as if they're sort of even when they're highly uneven, right? Just because it's a kind of, just because I'm interested in talking about a form of neoliberal globalization and the forms that it takes, doesn't mean precisely that it's kind of an even network, right? That there's access that's evenly distributed. And so I think, you know, the parasite is a figure of access, right? It's very much about access. So that would be like the beginnings of a thought about that. You know, I think the parasite is a figure that is an inside job kind of figure, right? It's necessarily so that it isn't eliminated outright, so that it has a certain kind of time to act, and it has a certain kind of trace or residue. And that has to do with the etymology of the parasite that I'm working with, which is before it kind of was taken up as a biological figure, it was this kind of weird actor that was able to sit at the table with higher officers because it had a certain kind of knowledge, right? Like it's a religious figure. And so it's about a form of lateral passing, right? So it's a kind of domestic actor in a certain way.
So I think, thinking about transnationalism in the context of data, there's kind of lurking, I think, both in like Cass and my projects, there's like, in the discourse about, right, extraction of information about individual identities, both in health records and on Facebook, lurking behind that is, right, the need for privacy or, you know, protecting user privacy, which is, you know, present in a different way in social media and health records. So, like, there are really strict, ostensibly, right, there are this, in the kind of health information exchange that I talked to, there is ostensibly going to be person-level anonymized data, you know, that will be accessible to individual researchers while they're doing their data. And that is going apparently to be HIPAA compliant. So like that's that is the discourse, but we know that, you know, breaches happen all the time. And those laws are actually very different from country to country. But I'm sure that somewhere, right, protocol feminism that Michelle Murphy talks about, she's really emphasizing how projects that started right in, you know, feminist mother goddess church basements in the 1970s as, you know, this kind of instanced feminist health clinic, what started there really became part of a transnational global apparatus of that operates under the name usually of like women's health, right? So I don't think that is yet happening in the same way for LGBTQ health, but I think I should likewise be asking questions about that. So kind of to answer both themes that came up.
Thank you for your question. Does it work? Yeah, great. Thank you, because I think that capital has been transnational for a very long time, and all the research which we're talking about has been there for a while, and that's why I mentioned it from the beginning, that for me, I think about it sometimes we call it comparative genealogies. With a colleague of mine previously, we had a group called Global Intersectionalities, of looking at these questions beyond a specific context. So they are important. Personally, I find that one person cannot do all of those different things. That's why collaboration becomes important. And this new project is already, you know, there is Sylvia Lindner sitting here, who is a specialist on this in China. And I'm working with people who know much more than I do about relationship to objects and self in Japan, which I think a lot of it is coming from there. But at the same time, what's interesting for me that sometimes this notion of the human, which seems to overshadow a lot of that, the human object or human animal connection, needs to be more troubled. And thank you for your question. I agree with you, it's important.
All right, I think there's a question back with Christian.
Oh, thank you guys so much for this panel. I really enjoyed it, and I enjoyed the breadth of faculty and student work, but it occurs to me that the next panel, organized by Anna, thank you, Anna, is actually showcasing the breadth of faculty and student work, but this panel's topic is what is digital studies? So I hate to put you on the hook, but the introduction did say there's a question mark in the conference title and we have to work this out by 6. And I totally appreciate that we can reason by example, as we just did, by looking at what you presented, but I wondered if we could also reason more explicitly, because I'd love to hear your thoughts. What is digital studies?
I can jump in.
Is that a question or an answer?
No, I don't have an answer.
Someone's gonna save us.
No, I won't save you, but I have a, to add to that, one of the things that it seems to me digital studies is, among a variety of things that you will tell us, is, you know, a way of doing histories of the present, but also with us inflecting towards the future, because there is some kind of anticipatory element that's usually bound up in the digital. And two of the panelists mentioned temporalities of 2009, which have to do, I think, with electronic health records and the way in which they can become more massified and also have greater movement because of the developments of the technology and also political will. And then you mentioned 2010 in terms of transition to broadband and kind of the, you know, sea change that brings. So I'm trained as a historian, and I'm kind of, you know, thinking about this, and if I were to plot this as temporalities, what does that look like? So is it useful to think about this in terms of histories of the present with all of the kind of theoretical baggage that comes with it? And what are the temporalities of digital studies for you? And that might, that's just, I'm just kind of piggybacked on your question. To throw that into the mix.
Does anybody want to answer that or add another question?
I'll take a stab. I mean, I had a bit at the end of my talk that I actually ended up taking out, but so I'll first just direct my answer to Christian, which is, you know, so what is digital studies? And, you know, for me, what I find digital studies to be is just another really good set of analytics for doing constructivist scholarship. And for me, constructivism is really three things. It's denaturalizing or deconstructing the world in some way, or identifying a problem and breaking up into its different component parts. Then once you've done that, taking those parts and putting them back together in a way that can make analytical sense, or kind of reassembling them. And third would be then giving tools to analyze that sort of reassembled world that you have kind of made sense of using a certain number of tools. And I feel like there are, you know, the history of, you know, I come from queer studies and the history of sexuality, science, technology studies. Each of these fields does this in a different way. And I feel like what digital studies allows me to do is it allows me to perform a kind of constructivist analysis of problems. Alex, we can call it, like, in my project is certainly a history of the present, not even extending very back very much. And I think that a lot of that has to do with just the scale of change that when I went into my archive, I encountered in 2009. But digital studies for me is just kind of another set of tools for doing that, which is really what I feel like I would be trying to do no matter what I was studying.
I'm afraid of this question. And I would explain, because I lived through the 90s of fighting for new media within schools of, like, humanities and art and design. And my first dean in National University of Singapore was George Lando from Brown University, who wrote Hypertext 1.0. And he fought his his fight in English departments, you know, around the country, for the right to do electronic poetry and research, right, on that. So I would say that strategically, it seems to me that what we're trying to do here, it's this critical, the notion of critical digital studies, which sometimes is identified, that it's not just a question of usage, but it's also a question of that methodology, right, of particular critical analysis of the histories of the present and the future. So that would be my kind of both, I guess, personal and just strategic response to that at this point. The heterogeneity of us I see as a strength rather than a worry. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now my turn to step into whatever traps there are. Yeah, I mean, my attraction to digital studies is the way that it gives us a way to talk about power today. That's not everybody's, right? I think digital studies, as I understand it, is about not just thinking about the kind of formal operations of digital technology, but the ways in which they produce historical, social, cultural formations, and studying those, and taking those seriously. And I'm invested in it as a critical project in the way that both Stephen and Arena have talked about.
That was a really succinct answer. I wasn't done figuring out my answer. One of the
paragraph.
I know. Stop. Don't give it away. one of the things that I do in my work to start with the temporality question, because I think it's easier for me to answer than the what is question. I study ID documents going back into the 19th century, which are an analog process of datification and of classification systems. So I actually start the temporality of my work starting with the sort of cultural logic that individuals can be mapped onto certain types of classification and datification structures. So I think about, like, I mean, like index cards on which mugshots appeared as an early instance of this logic that is sort of rearticulated through digital forms. So to some extent, I see the digital as an extension of a longer set of cultural logics in which human variants can be mapped onto data points and then reassembled and rearticulated for certain ends. And often those ends have to do with particular modes of power that are being extended through those technologies. So again, yeah, I think my temporality has to start somewhat earlier. I sort of tend to see the digital more as a structure for articulating those extant logics that was built with some intentionality behind those logics, as opposed to a mode of production that where suddenly we got the idea, oh, let's all take data on ourselves. That's not true. That goes back really far. And then the other thing I was thinking about, where the digital, as I was sort of gesturing to, the costs associated with producing cultural production in digital spaces are sort of shifted to different places and different actors. So where if you're not spending money to publish your book, for example, but you are spending money, you know, $60 a month to get internet access, then who is accessing and who is producing certain types of cultural content is sort of rearticulated in a sort of variant form. So you might have cultural production that is shifted to certain neighborhoods, but then poor people within those neighborhoods can start producing cultural production. So there's sort of different geographies or sort of different logics that a digital affords us to look at. That are particularly related to shifts in sort of material and I guess sort of like rearticulations of capital practice that I think that analog structures are sort of like importantly different than. So I guess to answer the question, in some ways I see the digital as not different from the past as long as we're sort of tracking certain types of logics across time, and other ways importantly different in terms of when things are paid for and who gets the access to make certain objects and circulate them.
I don't think my answer's right. I have a little bit of a digital studies imposter syndrome that I think comes from, for me, digital studies, it's the object and the set of practices that are possible. And so given that I've been kicking around pretty much the same 20, 25 years of industrial practices and cultural conditions, well, when those started, they weren't digital, and now they are. And so the questions that I am driven by have to do with what is now possible and why and how, and is very much focused on re-understanding media. And so I think if I would feel less like an imposter if this is what, or I would feel more on solid ground to claim it as digital media studies, because I do think digital studies is a broader thing, and that it's coming to develop its own canon and theory that's so much more significant than what this little piece that I'm dealing with is. But I think for me, it comes from what I see as a perhaps inconsolable rupture in my field, in that all the theory was based on a set of conditions that just don't work anymore. Or need to be considered anew.
I really like this. There's kind of been a theme throughout all our talks, and then I think in the response to this question, which is this idea of how digital studies helps us think about how digital processes are both the same and different than the past. So, like for example, of course, right? You have biopower and the avalanche of printed numbers in the 1840s, when it's people are at this moment when the states really begin to gather data about people. That is in the same way, the exact same process in some way that is happening when we're talking about an algorithm on Facebook collecting data about your name, or giving information to your doctor about your health that will then be aggregated into data sets, right? That is about collecting data that will then be aggregated. But digital studies then allows us to see that process as something that's happening in continuity with past processes, but then how digital technologies facilitate not just aggregation, but individuation, which is really a kind of a much, much different process that we now have data sets, at least in healthcare context and in, a lot of others, right, where, we're not just gathering data on individuals to create population data sets anymore. We're gathering data to learn more about individuals and populations at the same time. And digital studies allows to talk and see both of those processes.
So I invite other questions as well as other people who have maybe different or aligning interpretations of what digital study is from the audience. Sylvia.
Thank you. This was really insightful and stimulating. I have a question that is sort of related to Christian's, which is more about tying what you've all just said into questions of production. So it strikes me a lot of you have just talked about shifts in production and the proliferation of production and shifts in industry and shifts in who and what gets to make objects. So I'd be curious, do we also need a new theorization of production? Or how does production figure or play out in digital studies? I mean, there's adjacent fields like STS that has, you know, a lot to say about sort of history and the present of production and its cultures. And so I'd be curious to hear for each of you, you know, how production plays out, you know, all the way from shifts in industry over parasitic kind of resistance from within all the way to who and what gets to make objects.
Sorry. I think in some ways, so that question of, and I don't know if a common use of the word production can be assumed, but for me, production is the set of cultural practices related to the making of television for the most part. And so those are the questions that I'm trying to get to. And part of it is excavating these industrial shifts and figuring out how the playing field changes first. But it's always my fascination with those questions, which seem odd sometimes to my colleagues, is about production, is wanting to get to a point where I can actually answer a question about, is it possible to produce different things? Are creatives empowered in different ways? And so for me, the end of the day is about those production practices and the kind of texts that are enabled and the labor life world of those makers. But I'm still excavating the broader context in order to get to those questions.
Do we need a new theory? Yeah, I think we do. But I haven't made it up yet. I think that an oblique way of answering your question is to say that a lot of what I do when I study digital objects is to find vernacular objects. I don't have a background in studying production, media production. Like, I don't really know how TV works. Like, I just literally do not know how to get at those questions. But vernacular, I'd sort of like widen my bucket in terms of what counts as cultural production to include very commonplace everyday vernacular expressions of culture. So I might like look at it, like if we examine tweets, for example, as things that are not instantiated in a mode of this should circulate as cultural production per se, but in fact do work in the world as cultural arguments that have certain formal structures, that have certain types of relation to other types of, you know, digital objects or whatever. We don't really have a theory, I think, that I know how to, I don't know how to use a theory that can be in conversation equally with modes of digital or online production that have sort of deep production, right? That have sort of like layers and layers of production and response to the sort of one-off vernacular images that I'm sort of trying to work with. Why am I studying these like random pictures of random people's Instagram driver's licenses? Because that's what the people in my communities are making, even if those things don't signify themselves as cultural production. That's what people around me are making and doing and showing off as art and recontextualizing them as art practices. So I don't really know how to like get at that outside of the mode of sort of like, you know, are these sort of, are these almost random objects or are they produced cultural texts? I think that the digital asks us to fuse those two modes of looking at objects and try to like borrow from theories of both. So I'm trying to do that maybe badly.
Thanks for the question, Sylvia. It's a hard question. I think that, you know, the kind of most significant ways in which the digital affects modes of kind of cultural production, theoretical production, aesthetic production for me is the kind of velocity of response, right, that the digital produces, this kind of hyper-connectivity, this instantaneity. And so I'm really interested in thinking through what forms of aesthetic and critical practices are appropriate for responding to that kind of velocity of appropriation. And I think, what I think is most interesting is the kind of need to produce theory able to respond to that, right? Able to respond to a kind of embeddedness as opposed to a kind of critical distance, right? A kind of critical objectivity, able to respond to a kind of moment in which we are saturated and embedded and complicit. And maybe I'll just leave it there.
My work is really about the production of new kinds of data about health and about queer people in health. And there's a way that we can think about, there's a way that we can think about that data as, resembling this same idea of sameness and differences, resembling older kinds of health data that were gotten on paper records but are now being gotten in electronic records, so are therefore much more, production is intimately tied to the question of value in the market, so therefore much more valuable because the data can be manipulated in so many number of ways or exist in feedback loops with, clinical technologies that is going to make the healthcare system, for example, more efficient or, and there are tons of people making a lot of money on this process, right, of implementing EHRs. So there's a way that we can think about the production of new kinds of data, but then there's also a way that we can denaturalize what that data is by following sort of where it's produced totally. And this is very STS. This is where I go straight to thinking about actor network theory or Bruno, someone like Bruno Latour, who would want to. Okay, so we have this data that we're talking about that exists on servers and systems that is productive, that is being used by certain actors to produce certain kind of things, but that data existing as such relies on an entire supply chain of people. And I go then also to the digital labor literature, where the janitorial staff who is charged with properly disposing of servers at a clinic where data is gathered, or the intake, the people who digitize intake forms, for example, in clinics in order to make that data happen, the people who work in server farms where this data is stored. I mean, all of this is, we're not just producing data at an endpoint that can then be used, but all of these different actors are involved in making that process possible. So I think digital studies allows me, and other tools, and I would think that. I think that there's a lot of dialogue between folks in digital studies, Marxists thinking about digital labor, and folks in STS, these are the people I think with at least, and folks in STS who are thinking about that process of how do we, how do we write, how do we do scholarship that actually pays attention to that entire process of production, and not just production of value at the end.
Thank you again for a hard question. I would just say that I'm somewhat concerned that, again, we swing from feeling that we're moving into digital as dematerialized and everyone will be the same and so on and so forth, to real fetishization of matter, right? That with materialism, new materialism, and there is a certain fetishization of production of sorts, or even dropping production and calling it making. And it's probably because my office is in a studio building where everyone is making nonstop, right? Designers are producing and constantly, the object is the one which would be fetishized. And so artists are constantly making something. And so maybe I would also think about how to resist somewhat particularly this question and go back, I agree, to the issue of value, because whether it's material production or cultural production, ultimately it's the death of the author, remember that? Mm-hmm. Right, that the question of circulation of all of it and the fact that the value might actually come up not out of the object itself but out of the circulation at the point which is not necessarily predetermined by the maker. or by the factory. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I think we're out of time, but thank you so much, speakers. This was glorious. And coffee is on its way, I have been told, as well as some cookies. So we'll start up again at 2:30. So thank you. So a couple things. If you ask a question, please speak into a mic because the event is being live streamed so people can attend without being here. So I'd appreciate that. Also, this panel is a little different from the one that came before. It's a Pechakucha presentation, which is a format. It's a Japanese format that means chit-chat. And it consists of 20 slides shown for 20 seconds each for a total of about 7 minutes. But we decided to make this experimental Pechakucha, meaning we'll have short talks, but they may not be exactly in that way. So I'm going to introduce each person before they speak, and if we could hold the questions till the end, that would be great. So our first speaker is Jeremy Gibson Bond, who's a faculty member in electrical engineering and computer science. His areas of specialization include game design, prototyping, and programming, and his talk today is titled Choice Complicity Understanding, the Creation of Meaning Through Player Choice and Interactive Media.
All right, hey. I'm the experimental one. I didn't follow the rules, so let's see. My laptop barely fits on here. Okay. All right. Hi. So I'm going to talk about choice, complicity, and understanding. She just told you that, and you also just heard. Oh, hey, if I turn this on, it works better. You just also heard a little bit about my background here. I also wrote a book on game design that happened to be number one on Amazon yesterday in terms of video game design books and things. And I've done different things. It's probably important that I used to teach at the USC School of Cinematic Arts in Los Angeles. So I'm not a computer scientist for life. In fact, I have 0 degrees in computer science. I just teach there. So I am going to talk about somebody else's book to start off. So this is the book Hamlet on the Holodeck by Janet Murray in 1997. Many of you are probably familiar with this one. In it, she introduces this idea that, or she talks about this concept of incunabula, which are what we refer to books as before they really got to being books. It's books in the first 50 years of the printing press, as they were just trying to figure out things like page numbering and chapters and how long they should be and how big they should be physically and things like that. And there's examples of this in other media as well. So speaking of Hamlet, this is Georges Méliès' 1907 version of Hamlet, which is drastically lost. I've heard that it is lost, and I cannot find it anywhere on the internet. It was a 10-minute version of Hamlet. It was perhaps the first film to include crossfading to show like what's going on in Hamlet's mind. But it was him trying to somehow fit this five-hour play into 10 minutes, because that's how much film you had, was 10 minutes. And it didn't really work. It wasn't until much later. And this is not early, I mean, this is early, but this is 14 years after The Black Mariah was invented by Thomas Edison. So this is 14 years into film production, and they're still sort of finding their feet. It wasn't really until like 33 years since The Black Mariah that we have like this like unquestioned masterpiece, Citizen Kane. 1941, Orson Welles, who was 26 when he made this film, and regarded by many to be perhaps the best film of all time, certainly at that point. So let's look at this in my field, in games. We're looking at Zork here, Infocom 1980. Now, Zork, games have been around, electronic games have been around for at least 30 years at this point. But this was only 4 years after Colossal Cave Adventure, which was the first text adventure game. And you've seen these. It's you type go down, and you go down into this cavern where it's pitch dark. The important thing here is this very last line where it says, the trap door crashes shut and you hear someone barring it. And as Murray points out, the important thing about this is that you're not just reading about an event that has happened in the past. This is happening now, and it's happening to you. And that's what's unique about interactive media and what we do. And so what I want to talk about now is this piece of art by my friend Maddie Bryce. Maddie is a transgender woman living in the Castro district of San Francisco. And she made this game, My Nietzsche, in 2012, as kind of a letter to people who loved her, letter to her friends
to help them understand what her daily life is like. And as you can see here at the bottom, it says that basically, like, the goal of the game is you have 2 hours to get ready and you have to go get coffee with a friend. Doesn't seem that complex. And then as you get into the game, so she says, okay, I should try being more positive today. Great, I'll try and be more positive today. And I walk around and she's trying to get ready. And she tells me that she really shouldn't leave the house without some makeup. And then I go over and I decide, okay, yeah, I'm gonna jump in the bath. So I jump in the bath and then I'm walking around the house just to see what's there. And I see, oh, hey, I got some time to spare. Maybe I can play some video games. And me personally as Jeremy, I haven't played video games a lot because I'm super busy. So I'm like, this is a great idea. And I play the games, I turn on the PS3, and then, oh my God, it's time to leave. I don't have time to put on makeup, and I just run out the door. And I start walking to this this coffee meeting with my friend, and I walk over, and people start commenting on me. They say, oh my God, is that a boy or a girl? And you keep walking, and then this happens. And if you can't read, he says, hey, what up, pretty? Slow down, I want to talk to you. And he says, holy shit, you're a man! And he gets angry, and he starts, and you try and walk around and avoid him. He's like, that's, and he starts just continuously harassing you as you're just trying to move on with your life and get to your meeting with your friend. So you finally get to the coffee shop, and your friend says, hey, go ahead and order us some chai. And you go up, and you place your order, and the woman behind the counter says, hey, cash or charge? And I'm just like, whatever, cash, charge, whatever, I'll do charge. And the person says, thank you very much, Mr. Bryce. And this is a nothing choice for me. I choose cash or charge all the time, and it means nothing to me. But to Maddie, it's her choice of whether or not she wants to out herself as a transgender person because her ID and her credit card still have her original male name on them. So it is a huge choice to her, though for me in my personal life, it's nothing. Okay, so I'm not doing real well here, and I'm upset, and I go over and I get the coffee, but hey, there's this guy that I really like. And I try and catch his attention. So I'm like, hey, what's up? And he says, oh, hey, dude, not bad. Are these your drinks? Thank you. And so I get my drinks, and I go back, and I sit down, and my friend says, hey, you're looking kind of crushed. And I'm like, yeah, it's the usual. It's just hard to feel happy. And she says, well, you know, you shouldn't care what people think. The people who know you love you, and that's what matters. I'm like, all right, cool. And then it takes you back to the beginning of the day. And I should try being more positive again. All right, so but I know what to do now. I go and I take my shower, and I put on makeup, and I go find a cute dress to put on, and it's time to go, but I'm ready. And I head out into the world, and people compliment me on my hair, and then these girls want to touch it, and that's a little bit weird, but at least they're being positive. And then this same guy says the same thing, and there's nothing you can do in this game to avoid this, except to avoid everyone and walk on the other side of the street. That is the only way to avoid harassment by this individual. So I finally get to the coffee shop, and I know now that I say cash. I definitely say cash. And I say cash, and I get a much more positive reaction from the person on the other side of the counter. And I go to here, and remember, I'm all dressed up, and I'm looking good. And I try and catch his attention, and he says, hey, if you're sticking around, maybe I can sit with you on my break. And I'm like, yes, I'm doing it right. And I go down, and my friend's like, you look really good today. You look really happy. And I say, yeah, I think this guy's going to ask me out. And she's like, oh, I kind of see him flirting with a lot of people. And I say, I don't get asked out that much. Like, just let me have this. And she says, well, but does he know? You know, I just don't want you to get hurt. And so I'm still left feeling down. And it shows how every decision that she makes is difficult. And even the things that are good in her life have the potential of being problematic. And this is why she made this, is to really help her friends, like this woman that she met for coffee, really understand the things that she goes through and decisions she makes on a daily basis. And that's what I call in my book experiential understanding. And it's really about, if I have to make the same choices that she makes, then I can understand the reasoning behind those choices and the difficulty of those choices. And as she talks about this piece that she made, she says that it stands as a commentary of how we currently use game design for really broad strokes of universal experiences instead of the hyper-personal. I think that to me, what makes this so powerful and makes this my sort of Citizen Kane of games, even though it was made by a single person, and a piece of software that is identical to stuff that could have been done a decade or even two decades ago. We weren't waiting for technology, we were waiting for people's abilities as designers to be able to express something new in this medium through a new way. So it was made in RPG Maker VX, and Janet Murray talked about this in her book. She talked about how enacted events have this transformative power because we assimilate them as personal experiences, because we make the decisions they happen to us, not to some other, as happens in linear media.
A couple other quick examples of this, because I'm done with my time. Placement.org and the Minimum Wage Challenge, these are two games. One is virtual, one is an actual thing that you do in your real life where you live on minimum wage for a week. And in particular, the Minimum Wage Challenge has been done by several politicians and has helped transform their understanding of the choices that people face who are living on minimum wage. So that's what I got, and I went over time. Sorry.
Thank you. Okay, our next presenter is Christian Sandvig, who is an associate professor of communication studies in the School of Information, specializing in the design and implications of internet infrastructures and social computing. He is also a faculty associate at the Berkman Center for Internet and Society at Harvard University, and his research focuses on infrastructure studies, socio-technical systems, information policy, social computing, and HCI, and his talk is titled The Awakenings of the Filtered.
So are my slides going to auto-advance? Someone? No? All right. OK, that's fine. I read the instructions that you guys sent and followed them. But that's OK.
Sorry.
What's that? Sorry? Yeah, you have to type in the interval for each slide, and that will take a while in front of everybody. So. And I sent my slides, but I'm not seeing them here. All right. Do you know where my slides are then? Sorry. I feel like I'm being a pain, but I guess I could.
Do you recognize which one?
There it is, Pechupucha Sandvig.
Yeah.
There it is.
Got it. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Anna. Okay. Well, you know, I'm just going to get my phone and time myself because, you know, I know, but I want it to be like 20 seconds. Like, I went to a Pechacucha and I just was in my office doing this, you know, to practice 20-second slide transitions. And so I don't think if you give me the power to advance my own slides, it'll come out right. So I'm going to use a timer on my phone.
Do you need to advance for you, Christian?
Well, you still need a timer, right? So yeah. I guess I'm going to use your phone. But yeah, I mean, I like that actually. Yeah, that would be good. It'll be more exciting.
Cool.
Right. So all right, it's a challenge. Do you want my timer? Or do you?
No,
want
I'll just use my watch.
All right, that's
it. Should be a remote there as well.
And then could I have that mic? All right, there we go. This is more like what I was afraid of. All right.
Here we go.
Are you ready? Just
yep.
Tell me when to go. Ready?
Set. Go.
All right. So it all started when I found the Bic Crystal for Her pen, a ballpoint pen designed just for women. Feminists took over the rating page at Amazon.com, and they left 2,300 reviews. Reviews like, quote, I used one of these post-hysterectomy, and my uterus grew back. 1 star. Or, hubby feels these are unnecessary since he writes the checks. I thought it was funny, so I shared it in a Facebook status update. That didn't go well. I just got 9 likes. But in the weeks that followed, I kept seeing my update at the top of my friends' news feeds when I looked over their shoulder. Why? It turns out that Amazon was paying Facebook to show my update as an ad. This was just one of a long series of uncanny experiences with the automated curation of content online. Here, Google auto-completed how to raise your with how to raise your IQ by eating gifted children. You've had these experiences. The machine acts, and you wonder what process is behind it. This is my program of research. Why am I seeing this as a button that you can press on many websites, and it produces useless messages, like, based on your past behavior, or you liked similar items? But taken another way, it's existential, or it's a foundational problem in my field, which is communication and information studies. Why am I seeing this? This is actually a real ad campaign that was in San Francisco. The fact that computers decide what we see is as significant as the fact that we once relied on the word of God
according to Gillespie. I'd go further and I'd say algorithmic curation of experience is a new way of reasoning about the world that I've called the algorithmic style after a philosopher named Hacking. Is this really 20 seconds? Man, give me like 21. The ad campaign actually existed in, oh, I said that already. All right, the algorithm isn't a technical word. It appears in Chaucer. In computer science, they sometimes use the directions on a shampoo bottle as an example of an algorithm for washing your hair. But of course, this is an infinite loop, so it's a bad algorithm. The algorithmic style creates a problem of responsibility because the process for selecting content is complex and distributed. Facebook might consider 1,000 factors in deciding what to show you, and you control many of the factors. So relevance is co-produced. You train the algorithm while the algorithm trains you simultaneously. And this implicates you in anything that happens to you in algorithmic experience online. Interestingly, while other kinds of reasoning try to link cause and effect, in machine learning, a particular kind of algorithm, algorithms are optimized only to produce an outcome, like likes or clicks or time spent or purchases. And there may be no way to connect an outcome to a particular cause, as decisions are made by an opaque statistical process. The question, why am I seeing this, may be unanswerable. As Nick Seaver wrote, it may be unanswerable to the designers who can't predict the consequences of the algorithms that they themselves produce. If an algorithm's performance is substantially improved, sometimes engineers refer to this as adding magic. A series of very public missteps by algorithmic curation has produced a backlash against algorithm. This person seems to think that Donald Trump might be able to stop Twitter from moving to algorithmic curation. Last month's announcement that Instagram will switch to algorithmic curation produced a series of protest images celebrating our old friend, reverse chronological order. Returning to the idea of algorithms as opaque or as black boxes, the frustrating opacity of algorithms must be part of this backlash. Platforms de-emphasize the idea that they control content at all. Facebook prefers to use the word reorder or order rather than filter. Google PR describes its search algorithm as a robotic nose that smells web pages to detect freshness. The Korean art collective Shinsun Bak Kim Yong-hun has a piece called Cat or Human. It depicts a wall of Creative Commons licensed cat portraits that have been subjected to the OpenCV face detection algorithm. These cats are all identified by the algorithm as having human faces. Nearby in the exhibit, there's a wall of humans that have been identified as cats. This uses the Kittydar cat face detection algorithm. I take this artwork as an invitation to scrutinize these faces for clues as to why they were seen as cats and the cats as human. But to emphasize the impermeability of the logic of the algorithm, I actually was moved by this project to look up the Kittydar cat face detector and to read it very carefully. But even after doing so, I see that it depends on detecting what the computer scientists who wrote it called the distinctive ear crown. But even with this knowledge, it's not really possible to link a particular cat or human to a rationale for that selection. Pasquale says, a system too complicated to explain may be too complicated to be allowed to exist. But I am doubtful that complexity will be outlawed. I ask, could it be that focusing on outcomes might be enough as a research strategy? If you want to know why am I seeing this? This is a sock puppet. It asks, if we can only examine outcomes, how do we systematically find out what algorithms are doing? Your algorithmic result is not my result, for instance. This is the South China Sea. Working with a team of computer scientists and artists, we've developed a large number of sock puppets around the world. A sock puppet is internet slang for a false user account that you control. Our sock puppets experience the web in ways that we systematically vary, and this allows us to determine, for example, that users of Google Maps from some ISPs see a personalized version of national borders. An algorithm shows some people that China is 20% larger than other people. We call this work algorithm auditing. We thought we would find subtle and difficult to detect algorithmic differences, and while these exist, we also find stark and obvious algorithmic selection. This research is brand new. It's just being presented today in Montreal by my co-author. The sea is a slightly different shade of blue when accessed from China. I don't know if you can see that. It sounds like a poem, but it's actually a fact about using Google. A curation algorithm decides which shade you see. It might be quite difficult to tell why one sea is your sea. But as our experiences are increasingly mediated by algorithms, we have a duty as researchers to interrogate this new and potent axis of mediation.
This comment complements my earlier statement of why I am seeing this as a foundational problem. Maybe I can't answer it, and the correct foundational problem would be to measure Facebook's power. Facebook says, look at it, and that's my command to you. Look at it.
Hey, thanks, man. That was great.
That was a beautiful example of human-machine collaboration with Scott as part of the machine. So our next presenter is Leah Wallach, who is a PhD candidate in communication studies. Her research and teaching focus on transnational media, migration and mobility, the construction of public culture and minority media representation, production and use. Her work centers on South Asian diasporic communities' use of media as forms of identity work, and intercultural communication from a critical race, post-colonial, and feminist perspective. Her talk is titled Curating Community History.
Thank you all so much. Also, want to get the thank you out now because this is going to be crazy once it starts. Actually, we ready? I mean, am I ready? I guess is really the more important question. I did, yeah. On every page. All right. So thank you so much for having me today here, especially at this interdisciplinary setting, because I think that both improves our work and makes it more accessible and meaningful for audiences even beyond the academy, which I think is important. This is gonna be a fast and dirty look at a slice of some ongoing research, and I'm gonna race through it. It's gonna touch on insights from lots of different areas, materiality, affect, ideas from media studies, women, museum and archive studies, concerns about the erasure of labor and care. So this is developing work on the South Asian American Digital Archive, and particularly today I'm gonna focus on curation as a crucial site for working through issues of shifting power, agency, and participation, which is especially important as Cass covered for historically marginalized communities. But this is part of a larger project on South Asian American digital media projects over the last decade and change. This is clips from CP Mutiny. You can see some banners over there where they were often changing. Here's a blog post. Here are different numbers of posts. 5 main bloggers, over 30 contributors. This is really fast. Ooh, do you mind if I take just 1 second's pause? This is like a little hard to get used to. But I wanted to emphasize a plurality of voices and that it became a center of digital gravity for a socially conscious community who self-identified as South Asian American, which wasn't possible so much before. Okay, so back to the show. SAJA was the South Asian Journalist Association. It was 123 episodes from 2008 to present, and my emphasis in studying this was on the endless iterative labor involved to talk a community into being, one constituted fundamentally on the idea of connection and dispersion. It doesn't exist in any one place or tied to one nationality, but in the effort to repeatedly and imaginatively connect with each other, which is why my larger project is about connectivity overall. So here is Sri Srinivasan. He is on Twitter. He's hosting a podcast in this image at the Met. And in studying this diasporic community, it helped to reveal to me the ordinary and everyday constant labor that goes into managing and keeping connections, that connectivity is not a given, but something people have to work for. So I want to talk about curation today. And often in media studies, it talks about algorithmic curation, and also there's ideas of classical museum curation. This is the Natural History Museum. I want to talk about something a little different towards the curative work of the South Asian American Digital Archive, which an example will come up soon. This is their magazine Tides. So their archival work, they gather all of these objects, digital objects, but then more so they do this work of sharing and making it beautiful, making it shareable, and encouraging your participation. And here's my own curation work of my YouTube feed of South Asian American YouTube producers. So what does it mean when we shift to that kind of understanding? And why is that important? Well, recently at the same museum with the tiger, we had Beyond Bollywood, the exhibit on Indians Shape the Nation, which was an amazing experience for, I think, a lot of people seeing themselves as part of the nation for the first time. But this was not actually the first time that in that exact museum there was something about Indian people, contemporary, hypothetically, because in 1985, as part of the Festival of India, there was an event called Aditi, the Living Arts of India, where you go through a bunch of life cycle events, and there are artisans, and everyone's in colorful garb, and you're supposed to take on the perspective of a child because that's the most pure. There are a lot of really excellent Orientalist tropes. Here, the Christian Science Monitor tells us the colors look garish and some of the examples of modern art lack grace, but the real attraction of the Festival of India is introducing us to some of the finest examples of what is immortal in Indian folk culture and art, which then makes the exhibit I was just talking about, albeit a limited thing, here are some pictures from it, it could only do so much. The front of it was a lot of friendly things like music, yoga, whereas the back had a little bit more political teeth talking about what does it count to be a citizen, who can count as a citizen. It produced a sort of engagement that was entirely different, even if very hard to get to, and in a museum full of tigers and elephants. So, for example, when I was there, there were a lot of Asian American families there, which was really cool, as well as international Asian visiting. And there was a young girl who was 12, and she remarked to her grandmother, and the parents and grandmother were excited that this exhibit was there at all, that the idea of a turbaned Indian American was a racist way to note this information, which was a kind of interaction we probably couldn't imagine beforehand. So here is an example from a SADA page. You can see the kinds of ways it's organized. They do beautiful digitization. They leave the object in the hands of the original owner. Then they use culturally specific terms for sorting it. And in some sense, the base of it is these discrete entries on left. But really, I think a majority of the work goes into sharing it, displaying it beautifully, connecting it to related objects that span from the mundane to the personal, to the national, and the popular and civic, and helping people reach it. So here's the old mission statement back from 2010, talking about how it's about providing access, it's about documenting. It has a pretty interesting definition of South Asian diaspora, but the next slide is going to show us the modern values, which show a really strong commitment to how South Asian American history is American history, that case should be made, and that these true histories of America are built from the everyday, that you have to be involved. And an archive isn't a repository, but a dynamic space for dialogue and debate, which is, to me, a pretty revolutionary idea of what an archive can be. Including, they have a lot of projects that have scope beyond the community, like the First Days Project, where anyone in this room could go and interview someone who's an immigrant, or if they're an immigrant, put up their own story in text, video, sound, as you see fit. And you can search other people's by time and also by a map of place where people came from. So, relatedly, they've also did a Kickstarter campaign last year and got a book funded, a textbook, to go in actual classrooms. So this idea of a divide between studying digital media and these objects that are analog somehow is false. This fetishizing of just being digital, because the digital and the actual physical book can do different things. And in fact, I had a very strong response to them actually doing this, which they very carefully curated, I would, because they put my name and a picture on this post that then linked me and then encouraged me to post it onward, and I did, because the profoundness of the idea that my friend who hasn't seen himself in history could finally really got to me. But so that they put in all of this labor, more so than the labor of actually finding and collecting the content and sharing it, instead making it shareable, reminds me particularly about curation, that this new curation is about an iteratively produced whole that is more open to pluralistic experiences, meanings, and communities, and that is something I think is really worthwhile exploring.
Okay, so our next presenter is Scott Campbell, who is Poe's Professor of Telecommunications and Associate Professor of Communication Studies, and his research helps explain mobile communication behaviors and consequences. His talk today is entitled Mobile Communication and Social Communication, Old and New Directions in Research and Theory.
Thank you. Let me pull up my slides real quick. Okay. Here we go. Okay, so mobile communication has been around popularly for about the last 15, 20 years. And as a result, it's kind of become this new emergent field of study. There's a lot of scholars who identify as mobile communication scholars, and we have a recent journal that came out called Mobile Media and Communication, our own symposium and stuff. So the good news is that there's been a lot of scholarship on this over the last 15 years, and it's really kind of grown into a field and an identity. But some people are, some people celebrate that. Some people are concerned that there's a lack of theoretical structure in this new field, and that as a result, it's not as coherent as it could be. My argument in a project that I'm working on is that if we look closely enough at the literature, we can identify some theoretical structure. So I'm gonna walk us through some of the contours of what I see, my reading of the literature as theory. Some of the perspectives I'm going to talk about are identified as theory per se. Some of them are more like propositions that have been influential in shaping research questions, and so I'm treating them as theoretical as well. So I want to point out that one of the important pivot points here is the shift from the old 2G basic phone that primarily supported calling and texting, which was almost exclusively done with our core ties, mostly at that time, to today's 3 and 4G smartphones. These are not the only form factors, but this is what most of the literature is talking about. So I'll get started with the first one. So this is a pre-smartphone era perspective, kind of a dominant narrative in the literature, and it's about the way that people are connected with each other, actually disconnected from each other through mobile communication. I call this reaching in at the expense of reaching out, because it's about reaching into our core ties, calling and texting, at the expense. The idea is there's a zero-sum game where it's at the expense of being connected with weak ties or diverse ties or unknown strangers and civic life. Here's a quick quote. These are the names of some of the arguments. Together, they collectively reflect what I see as a theoretical perspective. Here's a quote from Kobayashi and Bose about telecocooning. The resources people have to spend on personal communication are finite, which can then lead to the strengthening of existing strong ties at the expense of interactions with others who are less familiar. There's a lot more quotes that I don't have time to get into, but it represents a perspective that a lot of people kind of shared at this time. And then when the technology moved into the 3G era with smartphones, we see a radical shift kind of in the narrative towards reaching in and reaching out. So we're still highly connected to our core ties. We're still texting and messaging a lot with our loved ones. But we're also, the argument is, through location-based technology and social media and apps, widely connected in all domains of social life. There's not a zero-sum game here. The scales are being tipped on both ends. We're more connected everywhere. And this is kind of reflected in Barry Wellman's theory of networked individualism. He argues that mobile communication is a distinctive revolution in the shift towards networked individualism, where people are more connected based on shared interests rather than shared geography. As he says, people are not alone, in response to Turkle's Alone Together. People are not alone, they are connected. He's talking about mobile phones here, too. They are connected with many others in a variety of social circles that provide them with diversified portfolios of social capital. So that's one of the turns right there in terms of less connected to people you don't know well, shifting towards being connected everywhere. And I'm not getting into the theoretical mechanisms and stuff because I don't have time. I'm just giving you a taste of the pivot points. So another major stream of research in the field is how people are connected to place, not just each other, but places of social activity and co-present others in those places. Like the first wave of pre-smartphone literature, the dominant narrative during the 2G era was that people were being cut off and disconnected from place. There's a collection of arguments. Absent presence is probably the easiest to grasp because the idea is that you're physically there, but you're socially somewhere else. Here's a quote from Absent Presence. This is from Ken Gergen. My concern is with the growing domain of diverted or divided consciousness invited by communication technology, and most particularly the mobile telephone. One is physically present, but is absorbed by a technologically mediated world of elsewhere. A lot of people were writing about this kind of stuff and trying to explain the norm violation and the disturbance of using a cell phone around other people and in public settings. Then with the smartphone and particularly location-based services, we see a real shift, a pivot point here in the narrative about mobile communication in place. In this kind of second wave smartphone era, the dominant narrative is not that we are trying to juggle two separate physical, like one physical realm, one digital realm, one at the expense of the other, but that these are hybrid places, both physical and digital, that are layered together, and that actually space or places are created through our movements to them, towards them, and away from them, and that mobile technologies and location-based services through check-ins and tracking and layering information onto physical places, that they actually augments the social experience and how we connect to place. A really quick quote. I'm going to spare you the quote. It's a really long quote, actually. So I'm running out of time, and I want to talk about another theoretical pivot I'm working on. Hopefully this one makes sense, though. So in terms of future directions, I'm becoming increasingly interested in not all of these perspectives I talked about are really trying to grapple with what's new here? What's the new aspect of this technology? When it was new as 2G, what are we worried about? When it was new as 3G smartphones, what are we celebrating? I'm interested in questions about what does it mean that the technology, just the basic ability to be connected anytime, anywhere, and to move about while we're using the technology itself. That's why it's different than portable. I'm interested in what this means when it's not new, this expectation. There's new devices and apps, but the mobile communication itself is no longer new. Rich Ling, my colleague, argues, he's a sociologist, that it has now become embedded, a taken-for-granted core assumption in our lives, and that it's actually part of social structure, the expectation that you have access to mobile communication. Without it, you basically fall through the cracks. This is a societal embedding, and I'm trying to move this towards a more embedding of the self, kind of like a complementary perspective that should be in conversation with social structure. This is kind of movement towards psychology, or maybe we can call it cognitive sociology. The quote that I've written in one of my papers to illustrate this, and I'll wrap up with this, is, just as mobile communication has shifted from a foreground artifact of attention to an embedded part of social structure, so too has it shifted from the foreground toward the background of cognitive processing. While this demonstrates a pattern of parallel movement across sociological and psychological fronts, mobile communication also intersects with these two fronts as a go-between in a chicken and egg cycle of mutual influence between social behavior and cognitive processing. Thank you.
So our last talk is from Joseph DeLeon, who is a doctoral student in the Department of Screen Arts and Cultures. His work engages with amateur media production in the post-industrial city, with previous work on the discourses surrounding urban decline in Detroit and the transgressive media practices of Detroit's urban explorers. His talk today is titled Mapping Digital Detroit.
So hopefully this will also auto-advance, and we'll see if that bears out in practice. Okay. Thank you once again for everyone. It's been great so far. I will be talking about mapping digital Detroit. Quite tall. And this happens both in reference to ways in which we can map the digital in relation to Detroit, as well as to explore an actual mapping platform that attempts to address blight in the city. So, as a Michigan native, I am very interested in how images of Detroit circulate globally. Sure, is this on?
Hello.
Great. And the ways in which that certain images of Detroit as ones of post-industrial decline stand in for many other things in digital spaces. One way in which this happens is through viral memes, for instance, that posit certain images of Detroit as these cemented forms that are sort of readily knowable and are related to other forms of visual media, such as video games, post-apocalyptic video games in particular, as well as war-torn sites and places throughout the world, such as Iraq, and another instantiation is Hiroshima after atomic bomb has been dropped. So these are very powerful images. And another genre that's circulated and criticized online is the ruin porn genre. And this ruin porn photography is often captured by professional photographers who compile these photos into coffee table books. And there's sort of a sublime aesthetic of overpowering structures and often a lack of humans in the frame. Urban explorers, on the other hand, see themselves a bit differently in cataloging the decline of the city, though of course the genre of this photo is equally problematic, some could argue. They intend to document structures in decline and to transmit these photos through their websites in order to document this process of change. And so one Detroit urbexer has actually found a collection of photographs of the former Cass Technical High School in Detroit and has put these over contemporary photos of the school in decline. So it creates this sort of tension between past and present. And one final genre of how images of Detroit circulate in digital spaces is the BuzzFeed listicle, which I'm sure we're all familiar with, which also posits certain images, usually of some of the worst cases of blight in the city, and describe these as what urban decay looks like. And so there's a certain positing of specific images and that are decontextualized, often without human beings in the frame, that tend to present a negative image. And so I'll turn now to think of a mapping platform in particular. Motor City Mapping was created by technology company Loveland Technologies and nonprofit Data Driven Detroit to map the blight in the city for blight abatement or demolition, as it's more commonly referred to. And so they created an app called Blexting, which is an awkward term for blight texting. And they created an app as well as a web interface where users can upload information in real time, take photos of structures, say whether there's occupancy, dumping of garbage, fire damage, et cetera. And the goal is to document and to track and to compile in an archive the most blighted areas of the city to target these for removal. And so this has been successful in locating areas that are most in need of abatement. But I would also say that perhaps in the attempt to provide a universal or maybe global image of Detroit's decline, this is the sort of mapped global image of the city here, that we might lose certain forms of community knowledge practices or things embedded in communities of color in particular that are often overlooked in constructing these digital platforms. And so one way in which you could see this occurring perhaps is through the Heidelberg Project, which is an open air art installation in the city created by artist Tyree Guyton. And as we see here, there's one house that was actually suggested for demolition. And yes, there's fire damage, but again, the questions raised of even if this structure was not demolished, ways of incorporating and addressing these community practices, art practices, knowledge practices is very important. This leads me to peel back in metaphorical onion a bit more and talk of the Detroit Geographic Expedition Institute, which was created by Dr. Bill Bunge at Wayne State University and was a project geared towards mapping forms of structural inequality in Detroit. And so Dr. Bill Bunge actively incorporated and recruited activists, young black activists and scholars at Wayne State to participate in the mapping projects, and they produced a series of field notes. And so we see these maps addressing in a, so this is post-1967, so after the Detroit urban uprising, we see the demonstration of these maps that attempt to address structural inequalities, structural racism, and the addressing of certain rights to the city, such as social mobility, that were heavily and important at this time, extending to today in sort of a long now of post-industrialization and responding to that. And so this leads me in particular to thinking of Gwendolyn Warren's contribution. She was an administrative director at the Expedition Institute in the early 70s after Bill Bunge, for his somewhat radical position, as people saw in Wayne State, he was let go. So she became the leader of the group. And so she was a young woman of color, and her subjective experience is sort of enfolded into the maps, which is very fascinating. And under her guidance, there's certain maps that, for instance, present a rather neutral language that a geography discipline would be amenable to, such as children's pedestrian deaths by automobiles, demonstrating the ways in which this happens throughout the city. But if we zoom in on a community of color in particular, this language is changed somehow. There's a different register where now we're locating where black children are structurally disadvantaged by the built environment of Detroit in between a more rich white suburb and then downtown where people are going to work. So we see this sort of radical activist tenor here that could inform contemporary digital practices. One website that actively incorporates the sort of rhetoric of these maps, as well as some of the intent, is DetroitOgraphy.com. They're somewhat directly inspired by Bill Bunge. So, in conclusion, I think we could think about sort of the prehistory of the digital mapped image of Detroit to see the ways in which we can incorporate this knowledge into understandings of the digital in relation to Detroit. Thank you very much.
Am I? Okay. I just thought I was gonna walk with the thing, not. Oh. No, it's fine, I'll do it. So questions for our panelists?
Hi, my question relates to the question of theory that came up in a couple of your talks, and also for the other talks, you know, how I'm interested in knowing how that how you think about that. It seemed to me that, you know, the genre of talks about the digital sometimes seem to me to involve a kind of exemplar-based presentation where, you know, we have specific examples of things that are out there that are digital products, and I think that showed up in several of the talks, you know, the web pages and maps that were presented to us, and then a reflection, theorization of what we make sense of that, as opposed to, I think, in your talk, Professor Sandvik, that the algorithm is producing something, but the backstory is inscrutable because of the nature of the algorithm that is producing it. You seem to be kind of hinting at, if I understand you correctly, at the kind of aporia that is produced in the theorization itself because of the generalized non-exemplar-based distributed nature of the substrate that is producing the knowledge. So I'm just curious as to, you know, I'm not sure I have a specific question, but I'm just interested in hearing from you what specific challenge the digital poses to theorization, both when we think of the digital as a means to an end or, you know, or as the object of study itself, you know, whether it is curatorial or analytical. Is there always a need for new theory, or as the last speaker said, that maybe could we use previous forms of practices and artifacts as a prehistory of a theory, and if it could motivate the kind of theorization that we need to do?
Hey, so I think, I don't know if I'm speaking for the panel, but personally, I took the experimental format. So I'm not sure if this format is representative of the way people think about digitality. The Pecha Kucha typically has slides with no words, first-person narratives, so I tried to match that. So I'm not sure this is the normal talk I would give. But after having said that, it's a really interesting observation about the example-based logic, and I really like your reading of my talk, which I hadn't thought of, so thank you for that. I really like that. I think, generally speaking, you know, we have these two modes, right? We have the digital as a rupture, a catastrophe that we have to figure out, or we have it's all been done before, and I just want to link it to the past. And so it's interesting that I wonder if there's some other way that we could go about it. Personally, I don't find the algorithm stuff that I talked about to be a rupture necessarily. You know, we used to talk about the media system as controlled by a bunch of rich television executives, and their brains are inscrutable to me, and I can't cut them open and see how their neurons work the same way that these algorithms are inscrutable. And so they made selection decisions that were also inaccessible to me. And so typically I don't see algorithms as being a totally new thing that you have to theorize completely anew. But it is a challenging research area because dimensions of it are very different. Like the idea that it's personalized, the idea that everyone's experience is different, some of the use of like trade secrecy or automation that's difficult to sort of figure out what's happening. But anyway, I guess I'm just saying thank you for that that observation.
I actually feel really, I know in the talk, speaking of the experimental format, I admit I had trouble figuring out how to work in the theory overtly, and I always feel really theory rich because I feel like we are voracious omnivores if we're digital studies people, because we are happy and interested to take things from everywhere that we think could apply, particularly the majority of people who I've worked with who are invested in the digital as an everyday resource and part of our ordinary lives. So part of already what we're already largely studying in sociology, where we're already studying in various genres. So for example, I didn't bring it out as directly as I would normally in a talk, but things like labor feminist concerns about an erasure of labors of care, or even Heideggerian ideas of care structures underlying the production of the world into a thing that is at hand and can be used and is meaningful for humans, right? But the Pecha Kucha didn't really feel like a time to drop Heideggerian care structures. So I feel really rich in that. And actually, there are a number of things that Christian's just brought up that I think I want to think about more, particularly that the vast divide between digital's rupture and as everything's been done before, new media, 1900, new media, 2000. But I think I'll turn it over first, because I think I've said the most central things for me.
In some of the work that I was talking about, the early work on being disconnected from place and how mobile communication cuts us off from co-present and others, that work is theoretically driven by, well, Irving Goffman is the most, he's the like most prominent theorist of mobile communication, and he's never even heard of the phenomenon in his life. He's been dead, you know, way long before cell phones became popular. And so I guess my point is that, you know, his theory about social behavior in public settings is all about the physical realm without the notion that there is a digital realm that's layered onto it or taking away from it or however you want to look at it. And he is by far the most cited theorist in my field, I would say, Irving Goffman. Like every single paper dealing with place will cite him. And it used to be that they're saying, you know, this is the way, this is the normative landscapes according to Goffman, and therefore that's why mobiles are tearing us apart. Now people cite him for saying, well, you know, he's wrong, and that's because of location-based services and stuff. My point is that it's easy to fall into theoretical ruts, and I think that that's what happened in my field. So I'm not necessarily saying we need new theory, but we need to avoid theoretical ruts because it blinds us from the way that the world is different, you know, the way that digital social space is layered and integrated with physical social space. It just doesn't work from a Goffmanian perspective at all. So I'm not going to answer your question about new theory. I'm just going to say we have to be cautious about too much old theory. And too many microphones.
Yeah. I honestly don't know how much I have to say. I'm from computer science, so I'm very out of my field here. But one of the things that we constantly run into when trying to curate is how difficult it is to get the important examples of our medium out and in front of people. I mean, even my Nietzsche that I spoke about is part of the art exhibit that's over here. But it's crashed right now, and so none of you can play it. I was going to mention it in my talk, but it's not running. And we actually on campus have, run by Dave Carter, one of the top three digital archives of interactive media and games and board games in the world, which is amazing. But even then, it's completely reliant on like those old machines still working after 30 years. And it's so much easier to get a hold of linear media now than it ever has been. And it's so difficult to get a hold of things that were made just 10 years ago and get them to actually run. So that's one of the issues I run into.
Thanks for your question. And just to rephrase it, because it's been a while since it was asked, like the relation, like the challenge of the digital for theorizing, like, because it may relate back to the issues with what is actually the canon of digital studies versus digital media studies. Is that loosely related to what you had asked? I'm sorry.
He said it wasn't a question, so you can say whatever you want.
Perfect.
He said it was a comment.
Great. So this is one thing that I can port in, because some of where my thinking comes from with thinking of like the map is thinking of Jonathan Stern's work on the file format, and thinking of different ways to analyze that as a sort of layer of like digital media studies. That's where my thinking sort of comes from, that it also is constraining in sort of what you're allowed to do within a given file format, but also provides an opening to visualizing certain things. It's almost imaginatively rendering like that, the aspect of like the file format and what it maybe could do is something that I initially was interested in exploring.
Other questions?
Okay, sorry. I was trying to judge how far away I needed to speak. Okay, I specifically wanted to ask the computer scientist a question, but then I know it needs to address the whole panel, so then, something that struck me that I thought was really interesting about the, this is nerve-wracking, how much of that game is an actual game, and how much of it is almost like something staged or like a documentary, you know? Because I was thinking like it makes perfect sense in a slide presentation, but then how long would it work actually on a platform where people would want to play it? Because like what I get the conceptual foundations of trying to explain to people who wouldn't know what it is, like what, you know, like what being trans means, but then like, I guess from like a modes of production standpoint, like what makes it like a game as opposed to something else? And then if the other people on the panel want something different, something I noticed between that one and then the one from earlier was the emphasis in at least those two pieces on like a very retro style of gaming, and which I thought was really odd or fun because all of like the theoretical work about the cyber stuff, about whether people are humans or cats, like the theory stuff is super complicated and dense with like convergence and all that, and yet it seems like the gaming culture aesthetic now is very, very retro, because even in your, like the gaming example, for as much as it is about trying to explain to people the difficulties of being trans or any situation, I thought it was deeply ironic because it's from a top view. So for as much as it is about trying to help someone explore that world, it's almost as like depersonalized as you can possibly get. So hopefully there's something there to bite on.
Sure, I guess I'll throw a couple of things in there. One thing that I find really interesting, the word game is very difficult right now, and frankly it has been for years and years. I mean, there were battles between philosophers in the 60s about what the word game meant and whether it could be defined at all. The book The Grasshopper is all about that, and I cannot remember the author's name right now. In my book, I talk a lot about more like interactive experience and how that doesn't have to be, that doesn't necessarily have to be a game-like thing or a designed experience. I talk about how, you know, if you walk into a Southwest Airlines flight versus a Virgin America flight, they're very, very different, and they're meant to give you a different experience to get you thinking differently about the airline and about who you are as someone who flies on that airline. So one of the reasons I talk about this game is because it's not a AAA title. It didn't cost $300 million to make, and it wasn't made by 600 people. It was one person's very, very personal thing. My friend Adam Laskevich, who's working on his PhD at USC, talks a lot about looking at the sort of overlap of games and poetry. And I'd say that this is meant as more like an interactive poem and an experience for someone to try and understand that, rather than like a traditional game, like where you're making a lot of strategic decisions and trying to get things out of that. The sort of older aesthetic that you pointed out, again, one of the reasons I picked this is to show that it wasn't the technology that we were waiting on to be able to express ourselves in this way. And there are some interesting things that come about when you look at things like augmented reality and virtual reality and the slightly different experiences that we can have there. But also, we could have told really meaningful stories like this 10 or 20 years ago, but nobody did, as I kind of mentioned. What we are seeing now is this more democratization of the creation of media, and it's not to everybody yet, but this was the first interactive piece that she had ever made. So Maddie is a critic, and she has written a lot about games. This is the very first thing she ever made with very little programming knowledge or anything like that. And there are things, tools like Twine, which Lisa uses in her class with her students, lots of tools out there that allow more and more people to create, and this is just one example of all the multitude of aesthetics and different types of interactive experiences that can be created now.
Anybody else want to weigh in on that?
The question.
Okay, other questions?
This question may be more a happenstance of who ended up on the talk and what your particular projects are, but one of the threads I noticed in each talk is this question about place. Christian used the example of the maps that are represented differently from different users. Scott's looking at mobile place development. Leah is looking at a specific community associated with place and so on, maps, and even the game, which is about the experience of going outside and going to the coffee shop. Do you think that there's something about digital studies that lends towards this look at the physical world and the physical place, and that, or is this perhaps just a question of whose work we happen to hear from today?
I just feel the perpetual need not to be Hermione Granger. So my personal feeling is that, again, this recourse, maybe I sound like a broken record, back to the idea that if digital media is profoundly pervasive and profoundly ordinary, then it is of necessity embedded personally and socially in our world, and therefore has to be part of the places that we go, and the places we go, and what the meaning we make about it has to be part of the media.
I'll just briefly say yes, I do think it points us to look at place. I think it kind of always has, like Castells, you know, talks about the space of flows, right? And so I guess even kind of classic digital media theory engages with place. And I think it's because if you can think of place as on the one hand, this objective area that you walk into and you experience, but most people would disagree with that. Most people would say, who really think about place, that place is something that's constructed through meaning and experience and our movements, that it's not just this object that we encounter, that we play a role, an important role in constructing it. And if digital media is part of the way that we create meaning, which it is, everybody's got a cell phone on them all the time, just that's my own, you know, there's, it's not just all about cell phones, I'm just talking about my own stuff. But then yeah, if that's part of how we create meaning and places exist through our creation of meaning, then I think it's absolutely crucial that we think about place when we're talking about digital studies.
I can take a stab at this too. So yeah, my focus is explicitly about like a mapping platform, so that brings space and place into the picture. But I was also thinking about this in relation to someone's question for the last panel about like the role of history in digital studies. And so it almost felt like by focusing more on a region, it opened up possibilities for thinking of like place-specific histories that could then lend an insight into, right, a built environment that over maybe 50 years has changed somewhat, but like the ways in which streets are organized are like still the same, and the ways in which people access certain things in the city are not the same, but are sort of parallel or similar. So then like by focusing on a certain region, it helped me to sort of elucidate certain histories that could overlay, so to speak, on like digital practices.
I so wish I'd brought up a notepad so I could organize better before responding. But this does bring to mind this idea that when you're creating a game and creating a place in a game, it's much more like a black box theater than anything else. You'll get nothing for free. I mean, if I went to shoot something on a campus, I'd just go out and show a camera, and there's all these things that I get for free. But as she's creating this, and she's creating this snapshot of her life, every single like 16 by 16 pixel block, she's deciding what goes there. And I think that as part of her life, it was very critical for her to represent not only herself in a vacuum, but herself in what her space is and how different that is from if she'd lived anywhere else in the world.
So. I'll try this. So I think space is maybe a pivotal access to understand digitality. I mean, it's really important. I have a project with an artist named Kevin Hamilton where we looked at Kevin Lynch and his sort of archetypes of urban design. So he says, you know, the way to think about space is as a path or as a box or something like that. And we argue in this piece that, you know, algorithmic experience or computational mediation of experience is really profound, because what it's doing is it's sensitizing you to the places that you're in a different way. It's prompting you to think about them using a different metaphor than you might otherwise. And a number of people have said this. I mean, Marc Monmonier is probably the most popular sort of popular chronicler of geography. And I think it was 20 years ago, he said, he looked at what computers were going and he said, this is gonna change everything for space, because, you know, it's basically the end of cartography. All the maps are gonna be different for everyone. Everyone's gonna have some sort of ability to produce their own maps. Everyone's perspective is gonna be different. And I think he was right, and he was ahead of the game. So I think this is a really key sort of dimension of digitality.
Did anyone wanna say anything more about space, place, from the audience, or ask another question? I have a question. I wonder if we can maybe draw a kind of through line between Joseph's paper and Leah's paper around the digital's relationship to documentation, and the way that you were talking about when the work of documentation can become pornographic, right? Like you were saying about this kind of ruin porn that circulates online about Detroit. And then Leah, when you were talking about this digital archive, right? And I wanted to ask a question, and when that is about, you know, work of cultural memory, right, work of certain kind of documenting the presence of certain communities. And I wanted to ask about the aestheticization or the kind of role of aestheticization in these forms of documentation, right? So I was struck, Leah, by how beautiful the site is, right, and the choice to make it beautiful in a particular kind of way. And then, Joseph, this would just be a kind of invitation to say something about the ways in which these memes circulate and are aestheticized in a particular kind of way. Yeah.
Okay, I'll give you a minute, and then you all have to deal with my thoughts also being unfocused. So first of all, that was one of the things that really drew me away from the actual digital objects. Although the work they're doing with digital objects, the work they're doing with copyright is really interesting at SADA, and it's groundbreaking and important to other community archives. But that the discrete objects in and of themselves were not the key of what SADA was. And they started in 2008, incorporated in the next couple years. It was a long and complicated process, and didn't actually, the majority of their work didn't happen until, of the archival work, didn't happen until later, but they had spent so much time laying the groundwork for the fundraising capacities that they have, for the tapping into the social networks that they have, and also choosing this beautiful, clean, smooth aesthetic that is delicious to look at and makes the whole thing go down very well, right, rather than something that is much uglier. And I think for me, it points to that labor that I'm trying to draw out and that I think is often ignored or erased and that I think is important, but also that double-edged side of being someone who's studying contemporary digital media studies when there are a lot of temptations of things that look beautiful and that I often think of it as something being used like by Apple, for example, right? And here it's being used by a community archive to make people think that South Asian American history actually is American history. And I'm not sure ethically how I feel about that use of aesthetics in that regard. So I'm gonna have to think on it more, but I'm curious to hear what Joe said. Does that help? Does that give you time?
Nice move, yeah. So I have a couple of thoughts on this in relation to like the reading of excess or like pornography in the images. So I almost feel like that's also differential to the extent where there's been sort of some talk through some online articles about like locals and certain Detroiters being antagonistic to any depiction of Detroit's built environment as like an incursion onto, right, some locally experienced process or thing. So that's almost like a, you know, not only I know it when I see it, but like everything is the not wanted image. But then also then the ways in which trying to read through, well then different ways of, I guess, picturing. So then the different practices that also produce quite similar photos is interesting to me. And I realized after I'd put the photos up, like, oh, you know, I could have shown all of those as ruined porn, but like they're sort of, they come from different places and they circulate somewhat differently. So I guess that's also interesting then, the ways the practices differ, but then the resulting images end up feeling, right? There's an aura of like ruined porn to it. So those are two aspects, I guess, that I would address, yeah.
I have an unformed question or partially formed question about the role of race and racialization as it sort of weaves through all of these papers. I think there's sort of gestures towards racial alterity and its inflection in the digital, especially interested in the reading of Mainichi, where, you know, even in the good scenario, she still gets street harassed. Surely that's in part because of race and racialization. She's getting harassed by someone who is digitally white, right? Like this little whitened pixel. And also the interaction with someone who wants to touch her hair is also hyper-racialized, even as the text circulates as a trans text in an unmarked way sometimes, right? So I'm just wondering if there are ways in which theories of race and racialization are intersecting with the work on digitization, or, and if so, how that might change the frame of the project, given that we tend to think about race interacting with digital media in terms of, in sort of clunky terms like the digital divide or like people of color don't have these things, right? So how can we like use the sort of texts or methods that you're bringing up to add complexity and depth to conversations about race?
So, I think that part of that was again the sort of limited time that we have. Maddie is very open about how you know this piece is not just about being a trans woman, but also being a mixed race trans woman, and that definitely adds additional challenges and racisms and such to her life. And I think that is very intentionally in the piece. I cut so many things from this that I wasn't able to talk about. So.
Can you talk about Maddie Bryce?
Yes.
So part of the interesting thing about
Maddie. Oh, yeah.
Part of the interesting backstory of Maddie Bryce is that she's not an American national, and so the ways in which she's acculturated to American values of race as she's done her journey have been really interesting to watch play out, especially since she's really good at being reflective online. So in answer to the question that I kind of heard when I walked in and made a lot of disruption, the ways in which people understand and articulate their reflexivity online and as academics, the way we should pay attention to them articulating it is one way to solve the digital divide problem. Does that help?
Yeah. Thank you.
You just hey, walked Anna. In and did that?
Yeah.
Hey, so I don't actually have a background in theories of racialization, but if you want an answer that's grounded more, I guess, in STS or maybe information policy, I think, you know, algorithms and race is a really fascinating area because probably the most common use of a curation algorithm for all of us is going to be advertising selection, because every time you see ads on the banner or on the slide, that's an algorithm making a judgment about what to show you. And that's a kind of a rough spot for advertisers in the United States, because they want to do marketing based on race, right? But there are laws in the United States about racial discrimination that would make it a crime to select based on race in certain circumstances, like, for example, employment, housing. And so what's resulted from this is some really interesting behavior by the purveyors of the selection algorithm. Like, if you look at Facebook from the marketer perspective, like you go to Facebook as though you wanted to buy ads on Facebook, and it has a statement on there that says race is not biological, which is kind of, you know, like, that's interesting, Facebook, but I wasn't expecting you to tell me that right now. You know, I thought this was about buying ads, but it has this little, you know, help guide to tell you that Facebook only tracks what they call ethnic affinity groups. And that actually anyone can be a part of an ethnic affinity group, and it doesn't actually have to do with race. But then examples are shown with pictures of people of specific races that obviously looks a lot like race, right? And so the platforms handle this in different ways, but I mean it's you know tricky because they are obviously skirting this for reasons of public relations, but also possibly for reasons of legal liability. So we know the algorithms are probably making judgments about you that look like race, or that are race but are called something else, but then how this is managed is this very difficult thing in algorithms. So
I also want to thank you for this because it helps me bring up something that was slaughtered in the brutal battlefield that was the Pachacucha talk, which is that part of the reason I'm so invested in thinking about curation in a slightly different way than Christian is that I think it's a necessary, in this era, it's a necessary complement to issues of representation, which especially in media studies and especially people who are not interested at all in sort of digital new media, et cetera, it's still an important idea about thinking about race and media and people's relationship with it. And yet there are, how many young people do you know who are watching network television straight on a television anymore? And how many channels are there? What choices are they making? And what are the layers of these choices that are being made from the personal selection level to personal friends who are recommending things to these alternative and community websites like SADA or CP Mutiny or Racialicious or different Twitter, people you follow on Twitter, to what they're recommending as web series, as TV shows and so forth. And what is that doing to issues of agency, power, access? So that's why I'm particularly invested in the term, which thank you for letting me say that now.
And I think was somebody else gonna weigh in or are we good?
Well, I just wanted to say that I think that we should
be thinking about these things, but also maybe not entirely give up on the old questions about the digital divide, because it's still playing out, just in a little different way. Like, we did a study a few years ago and stumbled on this weird thing where African-American teens were more likely to go online with their smartphones than their white counterparts. And you look a little deeper at the data and you see it maps on to socioeconomic status and the fact that they're more likely not to have a computer in the home. We're talking about a subset, not, you know, all of them. But it looks on the surface like the digital divide is fixed because they're going online with their handsets, but then during the focus groups, they're talking about the kinds of experience they have when they use the internet from their handsets and the fact that they have to get jobs and pay for this really expensive service themselves. So even the old questions still need to be kept in mind, but maybe framed a little more nuancedly than who has and who doesn't have.
Okay, and I think we have time for one more question.
So I kind of want to make a little bit of a left turn at the end of the panel and pull a Christian Sandvig. This is what he did on the last panel. So right, we're at the What is Digital Studies mini conference, and I come from queer studies, where we queer studies and, you know, adjacent to feminist studies and women's and gender studies, which does a lot of generative but sometimes sort of annoying, but also generative hand-wringing about institutionalization and how. These disciplines become part of institutional life at universities. So, you know, and I just want to pose the question to the panel is, if do you have a vision for the institutionalization of digital studies? Because, you know, we can imagine situations where there might be future departments of digital studies, but currently people who do digital studies almost in every discipline, right? Someone's doing it. People are doing it in a lot of different ways that are operating under the rubric of digital studies. Here at the U of M, right, we don't have tenure lines in digital studies, but we have this very generative, interdisciplinary collection of folks in digital studies housed within American culture, which signifies quite differently than if it was housed somewhere else. Name any other department. I'm not going to single anyone out, but having it housed in American studies means something. But still, it's not its own department. It could be. It's happening differently at other institutions. Do you have a vision for how we should institutionalize digital studies based on your just opinion or maybe disciplinary vantage?
I do not have an answer to this, but perhaps further like provocation in thinking too that I don't know if anyone said the words digital humanities yet, which is like interesting. And so that's interesting, right? But then also the ways in which we can think perhaps then at Michigan, digital studies is housed in American culture, how sort of that framework can inflect then the ways in which the digital has entered into colloquial, maybe academic usage and other means, or like the types of production tools that are attempting to cross disciplinary boundaries, which is, I think, digital humanities is trying to do in sort of its scope, is like to provide new avenues for publishing research and for researching itself, analyzing corpus of text and stuff. So by being housed in American culture, I'd say it's an asset as well to explore different ways we can render, like, you know, stay at dusty disciplines, like, somehow different, yeah.
So I'm going to answer in terms of game design, which is a little bit different from what you asked, but it's what I know about. One of the things that we're wrestling with all the time here at Michigan is how siloed anything having to do with interactive experiences or games are. I mean, Lisa's got her classes, I have mine, Sophia's got her classes, and we're all over the place doing these very, very different things. And like my class that I teach now is actually probably the oldest class in game development in a computer science program in the nation, but they never went anywhere beyond a single class with it. I think that as we look at this, what we're going to find is that really what we're all getting at least from a design perspective, is this concept of a group of people or a person comes up with an experience that they want someone to have, feelings that they want them to feel, and they compress that into, if it's a board game, rules, or if it's a digital game, code and music and things like that, and then that is decompressed by play. And if it's a game like Go, it's decompressed by play 4,000 years later and is still the same experience that was conceived of back when those rules were written. And I find that really, really, really compelling. And I think that's much more broad than a single class in a computer science department. So.
And we just have another minute, so.
So this reminds me so much of STS. Because STS had these fights about this a lot, right? Like, what is STS? Are you an STS? Are you an STS? Is it okay? High church STS, low church STS. I'm not sure what they got out of that, right? I mean, it was a lot of work and a lot of fighting. And so I hear the question, and it just makes me tired. You know, I just think, like, God, what is digital studies? We have to fight about that too? Who cares? Let's let everybody in. Sounds great. Is it digital studies? Is this cup? Yeah. I know, that's my answer. I wanted to hear their answer on the first panel. But my answer is this cup is digital studies if it wants to be. It's fine with me. So there are some other questions, though, that, you know, in STS when they were fighting about the definition of themselves that they were asking, and those questions really get me up in the morning. And those questions were like, you know, Langdon Winner attacks High Church STS and he says, you have no morals. You know, this is apolitical. What are you guys doing here, right? Like, this is technical and it doesn't serve anyone. Like, that's the kind of debate we want to have. Then I say, yes, let's do it. Okay, that's substantive. But the question of, like, how do we draw the box or whose office is in what building? And I mean, I don't know. It didn't help them.
Oh, it sounds like Jim. Can I comment? Because it's interesting how this actually brings us back to the space question in a way, because what is digital studies? It can be a question about what it is as an object, or is it housed, you said within, which I react against, because it might be housed in American culture, but it isn't housed within, right? But it's really a question about what are the good ways to institutionalize particular conversations, right? And that is actually a different and more answerable question, right? And so the institutional question takes us back to the theoretical question. I mean, it didn't seem worth speaking up to say, but maybe digital studies is about space because everything is about space and place, and that those questions come up just as much. If you start really getting down to foundational questions about how connections work, that you do wind up thinking about place. And I'm looping it back to digital humanities because, in a way, the reason I said I have to speak up and ask this question was that what I would do as a humanist is ask the question, are we sure that the experience of that game is actually the same all these centuries later, or might it actually have the same rules and yet be a different experience, right? And that the productive dialogue is actually a lot about what the very old-fashioned methodological distinction between the ideographic and the nomothetic, those of us who are interested in reading particular texts and figuring out what does reading that text and understanding that text, as opposed to being interested in what are the rules here, right? What are the structures and what are the big things? And that's going back and forth all the time in this panel. And I keep thinking, I was going to tell some stories about how writing and books and fiction changed everything in ways that are very parallel to the ways that we're talking about. So now we're in the complexities of time rather than the complexities of space, right? But it all does wrap back to what lets us be together in this room, what institutional structure lets us be here asking these questions. So I have just alienated myself from the title of our own conference here.
So it falls upon me to curtail this conversation for now, which I hope we can all continue. So take 15 minutes, take a break, and we'll come back together at 4:15 for Wendy Tun's keynote. So thank you all, and let's thank our panelists.